to call the meeting to order. This is the regular board meeting of the Regional County Commissioners. It is January 10th, 2018. It is, according to the clock on the wall, about 10:02. We were posted for 10 a.m. We are located at the County Commissioners Meeting Room at the Superior Courthouse at 3195 Main Street in Barnstable. And I would like to ask you all to please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If you all could please remain standing just for a minute for a moment of silence for all those who have died in the service of our country, and presently for prayers to those that are now currently serving, protecting our freedoms. Excellent. Thank you all very much. The next thing on our agenda is public comment. I'm going to recognize, we have a department head here. There were some questions last week in regards to some actions that we were being asked to take. So if I could have a little leeway and ask our department head to come up during the public comment section. This way here you won't have to wait around for our entire agenda. And if you could just kind of give us a brief explanation of the request that was in front of us last week, and hopefully that'll suffice.
Okay, Mike McGuire, Director, Cape Cod Cooperative Extension. I asked Diane Murphy, who runs our marine division of our department, to come in and explain the bid and the way it worked.
Okay, thank you. I think there was some just basic questions on, there was no dollar amounts. There was basically per can't remember now.
Per thousand of seed, perhaps.
Yeah. How that actually works.
Yeah, this is a propagation program that we've had running since 1999, where we get together with all of the constables and all of the 15 towns of Barnstable County to put out a bid to purchase seed for their resource enhancement. Now, this bid process, because we put it together, and we can then go out to bid. We can buy in bulk, and the towns get a better price. This bid goes out to all approved hatcheries according to state Division of Marine Fisheries. It cannot go, across the country, but they have a list of hatcheries that the towns can only buy seed from. And it's open to all of those hatcheries, and then we receive the bids, and this is all put together with from our office and Elaine in finance. And
I think, if I may, just give me a little leeway here. I think the question was in regards to the county's share of this actual bid and how it is structured, because it appears when you read it that the county could be on the hook for $300,000 if in fact all the towns decided they wanted to buy
There's a set amount that we have. We just found out funds were released from the state, $58,333, that's to be shared amongst all of the towns, and then the towns piggyback on that and buy additional seed. But that comes out of their town budgets. That
Excellent.
Is not additional monies that
so the county share is capped at a certain amount.
$30,000. We, the county, actually our marine program budget, we put the $30,000 toward that, and that augments the $58,000 from the state to more purchasing power, and then like I said, the towns then as much as they want to buy, but that's their budget. That's not what, we're not on the hook for that.
All right, thank you. I was under the impression that we were actually going to have that contract on the agenda, and that's why I asked Mike to have you come today, but it's not on our agenda, but I think we've certainly covered it under the public comment session. Mike, while you're sitting there, we do have a long agenda ahead of us, including some budget hearings, but there is a, under Commissioner's Actions, number C, which is a grant. I believe it's going to be an amendment to an agreement. Do you want to just be available? Yes. Be available? I mean, do you want to just let us know what that is? Rather than hanging around all day here.
Yeah, I appreciate the opportunity. Thank you. So on 9C, there is a request for authorizing the execution of an amendment to an agreement with United States National Atmospheric Administration Noah Hui, which is where we've gotten funding before for our community rating system person. And so Hui Sea Grant has agreed to give the cooperative extension another $30,000. That's split out into four line items. Salary and fringe are going to make up about $9,344 that can go towards that position in next fiscal year. The remainder is in admin and travel. So, and the travel would actually go to all of our Marine staff to do continuing education and networking so they can travel with their across the country and do all the education and networking that they come back to you and report on. You've heard from them several times this year. Right. So that's what that $30,000 is.
Is that $30,000 that's going to affect our, it says for a period extended for performance through August 2018. Mm-hmm. So whatever's left over, we're going to transfer into the FY19 budget?
Yep. So I would propose that we would use the funding that they're going to allocate towards the CRS position in FY19 to offset the operating costs for that
person. We can talk about that when we do the budget.
But so that's just so you know what it is.
Yeah.
And I would go back and just to what Diane said, this is an important program that the county offers. The county procurement officer who does go out to bid for all the towns to get these seed prices, the impact of what we've done can be seen in this one pager. I wanted each of you to have it.
Yeah, we have one. Jack just handed that.
Great. So that's just something for your review. And there is a state line item. Do you have that number? I would like you just to be aware that each year in the state budget this year, Rep. Fernandez filed it. Used to be Madden used to file this. There's a $175,000 line item that is in the Division of Marine Fisheries. It's account 2330-0100. And that's a line item for $175,000 to be split between Barnstable, Dukes, and Nantucket counties for a seed purchase. So that's that gets split three ways, the 175 grand does. So the 58,333 and change. Comes to the county, and the county adds that on to the bid, and the towns tell the county what they'd like to buy as far as shellfish seeds. So that's all part of the enhancement program. But you can see the return on investment is significant. So,
well, thank you for clearing that up.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Again, I don't want to get into it too much because it's under the open session, but
got it.
Maybe when we do our budget, when you do your budget presentation, you can be available to answer some questions.
I would encourage if there are any further questions, please feel free to contact me or anyone in my office. We're always there.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else for public comment? Mr. Ullman, come forward, please.
May I take something out of the car? I appreciate it.
Yes, sir, Mr. Ullman.
For the record, my name is John Ullman. I'm the dense representative of the Barnstable County Assembly of Delegates. I have a comment and a request.
Okay.
And it won't be brief. I'm going to read it so I can not take much of your valuable time.
Do you have it in writing that you could give it to me too?
I'll give it to you right after I read it.
Thank you.
I'm here to speak to the upcoming leadership transition at the Cape Cod Commission. We will truly miss the leadership skills and vision of Paul Nizowicki. I've served with all three executive directors, and Paul's unique management style has brought Barnstable County well-positioned into the challenges facing Cape Cod in the upcoming years. One of his management decisions was to create a qualified succession plan if and when it came time for him to move on to other challenges. That time, unfortunately for Cape Cod, has come. The good news is that we have in-house a highly qualified team to lead Cape Cod Commission into the future. I've heard that there may be a wide search commissioned to find Mr. Nizowicki's replacement, and there are situations where that's applicable. But here in 2018, with Paul's visionary leadership, we have already have that leadership in place. Christy Centauri has served as Deputy Cape Cod Commission Director for years and has been intricately involved in all important initiatives the Commission has undertaken. I urge you to consider Ms. Senatori as the logical and most qualified to lead Cape Cod Commission into the future. It's the right thing to do, and the right time to do it to ensure the success in protecting Cape Cod's unique legacy into the 21st century. Thank you for that.
Is that both your comment and ask?
Yes. Then, no, that's my first one. Secondly,
well, on this one here, just so I can answer you, I'll be happy to take it. I just want to refer to the state statute that created the Cape Cod Commission. It is not this board that makes the decisions on whether to go out for a Cape-wide search or not. We act on the recommendations from the executive committee of the Cape Cod Commission. I will forward your written comments to them, so they will have it in front of them at their next meeting. But you may want to.
What is their next meeting, sir?
I believe they have an executive session. I'm sorry, executive committee meeting scheduled for this coming Thursday before the regular session of the Cape Cod Commission.
Tomorrow.
Yes, I think it's 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock.
Two. Okay.
But if you'd like, if you can't make it, I'll make sure that this gets forwarded to them.
If that's not appropriate for you, I'll hand it to them.
No, not at all. I'm more than happy to hand it on to them.
And secondly, you were kind enough to give us a synopsis of the myriad of open meeting law violations and gave us an approximate value. But I would like to know if you can give us a timeline in a specific of all of those.
You didn't get that yet?
No.
I'm very sorry, you'll get it today.
Okay. I'm speaking for myself as far as...
No, it was supposed to be sent to Janice. It's an oversight on my part. It is a actual chronological breakdown, the actual bill itself.
And the width of it to each, like the Cape Cod Commission, the Assembly, County Commission, as I understand what
it says, talk to Leo, charge me $15, talk to such and such, charge so much. You'll get that breakdown. I'll make sure you get it today.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
I'll be standing
nearby. And again, I'll make copies of this and make sure it gets forwarded to the right people.
Very good. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Ms. Dolman. Any other public comments? Okay, seeing none. That brings us to our regular, back to our regular agenda, which is Section 5, budget hearings. If you would all indulge me, and certainly Ron, if you would indulge me, we have 6 people, 6 budgets to review that we'll be presenting today, and we also have some minutes to approve. And on our, under number 8, number 7, our general business, on the agenda is an update from Paul Nizwitzki. I noticed Paul just walked in the room. I was wondering if you would mind if I take number 7A out of context so that Paul doesn't have to wait around for all that. Do you mind, Paul, coming up now?
Yeah. Great. We can ask him questions. Right?
Absolutely. So on the agenda it says update from Paul Nizwitzki, the executive director of the Cape Cod Commission, as well as a discussion and update on the possible recruitment and search for a new executive director in the event a vacancy should happen. So we just heard from the all-knowing, all-soothsaying John Ullman that you are in fact moving on. So I guess you're here today to give us that officially, that official.
I am here today. I have submitted a letter of resignation for your consideration. I will be moving on after 10 years at the Cape Cod Commission. I'll be accepting a position to be the first executive director of the Southfield Redevelopment Authority, which will oversee the development activities at the former South Weymouth Naval Air Station. And I just want to say thank you to the Board of Commissioners, present, past. Thank you to you personally, Mr. Chairman, for your assistance through this difficult decision-making process and this transition. It's the most difficult professional decision I've ever had to make to leave. But you know, after 10 years, the commission is in good shape. I think I've met the goals that were set for me 10 years ago, and we've tackled some really big issues. And as I look back, you know, over that 10 years, there are a lot of things that we've done, a lot of accomplishments that we've made. But the thing I take most pride in is the staff that I've been able to develop there. And they are incredibly competent group of individuals. So I leave knowing that we will continue on that course. That eases my decision a little bit. But I am grateful to the Board of Commissioners of Barnstable County and to all the residents of Cape Cod for the opportunity to lead this organization for the last 10 years. And I know that I'm leaving the best job that I will ever have. But it's time.
Well, I'm going to stop you right there, Paul, because I just want to say for the record again, you know, thank you for your service here. You've certainly brought the Cape Cod Commission in a direction where a lot of us thought it should be going, and it really goes back to you. But it also has a lot to say about leadership when people step up to the plate and leave, knowing that they're leaving a good legacy behind and leaving an organization that is operating at the most efficient way it can operate. You know, I'm not going to compare you to George Washington, but you know what? He was our best president because he knew it was time to move on. He would have stayed on until he probably passed, and he knew it was time to stay on. I will compare you to myself a little bit. I certainly don't think that being the president of Farm Bureau compares to being the executive director of the Cape Cod Commission. But I found it a very personal, difficult decision when I stepped down from president of Farm Bureau, because quite frankly, I probably would still be the president there today. But it was time for me to move on from that organization. I had done what I could do, and there were right people in the place, and I moved on. And I think it says a lot about leadership when we make that decision. The only other thing on a personal note, thank you for considering me somebody that you would confide in this decision, because I know it was a very, very difficult decision for you. I'm kind of caught between a rock and a hard place. Personally, as I told you, I think it's a great decision for you, and I'm glad you're moving on. But for the county, we're going to be going through a lot in at least the next year or two. And I'm going to miss you being there, but I will rely on you. Believe me, I'll be calling you from time to time. Did you have anything you wanted to add to that before we get into the second part of this?
I just want to say that Paul has definitely changed the direction of the Cape Cod Commission from the way it was going with his predecessors, from being more of a regulatory agency to be more geared toward planning and economic development. That's without question, especially with the growth incentive zones and so on and so forth. I know he was very passionate about being the director of the agency, putting it lightly, but that's a good thing. Other than that, I would like to get into the next part of it.
Yeah. Paul, then, I've already said this during the open session. The statute that created the Cape Cod Commission is pretty clear on the procedure for the replacement. I know that you know, you've met with the executive board. I know they're aware of the procedure. But I think maybe publicly, if we can just, without getting into the weeds or anything, but at least I'll let people know so that in the event people like Mr. Ullman that just wanted to make a comment to us about it, and certainly so that I don't have to field 400 phone calls, I want to be on the search committee kind of thing. Can you please let us know? Sure. Let's talk about where we go from here as far as replacing you.
No, I'd be happy to do that. The Cape Cod Commission Act governs how the Cape Cod Commission runs. The Cape Cod Commission is an agency within the structure of Barnstable County government. As it relates to sort of vacancies at the top, all staff appointments. All staff appointments come to the Board of County Commissioners based upon recommendations from the Cape Cod Commission itself. As it relates to staff in general, that comes through the executive, through the commission, through the executive committee, and has been sort of subjugated to the executive director. We run the hiring process, we make decisions, we forward the name to you for the appointment. A similar process is in place for the executive director, according to the Cape Cod Commission Act and Sections 3H and Sections 4 generally, backed up by legal memos both from Rackman Sawyer and from Pierce Atwood over the years, so that the executive committee of the Cape Cod Commission would handle the search. Now, they could go out and hire a search consultant to sort of help them along, where they could do it themselves. They would field, they came up with a policy. Their policy is that they would look internally first. They found qualified internal candidates. They would submit and make that recommendation to the board for your consideration. If there are no internal candidates, then they would go out and do the broader search. They're not required to do that necessarily by a vacancy, but if they're going to fill the vacancy, then they do have the ability to do that. So given the current situation that we have, where early retirement is pending, there'll be five or six people that might leave the commission, given some of the budgetary concerns that we have, and given the latest sort of updated regional policy plan that's underway and about to sort of be discussed publicly over the next few months. And it's sort of the, you know, my sort of leaving as soon as I will. The thought is that Christy Santorio, deputy director, who is very qualified and very competent, will become the acting director, and that you should discuss with her the tenure of that acting directorship. Based on what we have in front of us, I think next January, if there were going to be a search, that would be the appropriate time. That's been my recommendation to the executive committee. But they handle that process, and they are meeting at 2 p.m. tomorrow to discuss it more in more detail, and they will be forwarding that recommendation to you for your consideration.
Just something wrong?
Yeah. When you were originally hired, was that the exact protocol of the search committee?
The executive committee went through a search committee. They recommended three names to the county commissioners. The county commissioners rejected those three names at the time, and they wanted to go back out for another search. The executive committee decided that they did not want to be part of a second search, and so they delegated that responsibility to the commissioners themselves.
They delegated to the commissioners?
Yes. They defaulted.
So in my mind, this process is actually not as cut and dry as it was laid out just now, because using the search process that went on with you 10, 11 years ago.
You might be able to question the legitimacy of that process 10 years ago, but okay. I don't think you can question the legitimacy of the Cape Cod Commission Act itself. It is the law,
no,
the law is clear.
I checked out 3H, and it does say at the recommendation, but the process itself is not laid out in there.
Itself was adopted by the executive committee.
Right, and internally. You have written memos on that, you
yes.
mentioned? Is it possible to get a copy
absolutely.
Of those?
Absolutely.
Okay,
absolutely.
Thank you.
My only comments on that is, again, when we go back to the way it was done 11 years ago, they followed the process that we look like we're going to follow now, and then there was some discussion between the then county commissioners and the then executive committee,
yeah.
And as you just outlined, the then executive committee authorized the county commissioners to go ahead and do a second search.
Right.
So that's not precluding that same thing from happening again and again and again.
No.
It still puts the burden, first and foremost, not burden, but the authority, if you will, on the executive committee. And we have
yeah.
to allow them to at least do what they want to do first.
No,
if we decide we don't agree with them and we don't want to accept their recommendations, then that opens up the door for negotiations then.
Right.
But let's not talk about something that probably
yeah.
won't happen.
No, and I think the executive committee wants to include the Board of Commissioners. They don't want it to be a separate process. So they're definitely
no,
seeking input. Yeah, but this process is in keeping with the Act in general, if you sort of read through that. I mean, the Cape Cod Commission, as it relates to things like the regional policy plan or the designation of districts of critical planning concern, the commission, who generally acts as a quasi-judicial body in reviewing regulatory matters, has sort of a legislative function in developing the regional policy plan. That's forward to the Assembly of Delegates. The Assembly of Delegates can either reject or accept in whole, but they can't amend. And then it comes to the commissioners. And so there's a framework of how the commission fits into Barnstable County government that's consistent throughout the entire act that supports the interpretations of Section 3 and 4 that the Cape Cod Commission would handle the search as we do all other sort of recruiting searches, and we'd make recommendations for your approval up or down based on the three candidates. And if not, if you don't find any of those candidates, that would go back to the commission. I mean, that's happened with versions of the regional policy plan in the past, where the assembly has not accepted things that we put in front of them. So they've detailed a memo as to why the problems that they had with what we put in front of them, and it goes back to the commission for its consideration. But they're sort of up and down votes.
So going back to when the search process, when you were brought on board, what was the time frame from start to finish, if you recall? They took, was it like 6 months or something like that, or a year? Or?
I don't recall how long the initial process took, because I was not part of that.
I'll venture to say it was around 6 months, if
yeah.
I remember correctly.
So it's a lengthy
process.
I was
on the Cape Cod Commission at the time, so.
It's a lengthy process, it can be a costly process, and I would say when the commission last went out to look for a new executive director, they also had a Blue Ribbon Commission report on the commission itself that had some recommended changes, and there was a general sense in the community, certified by that report, that there should be a change in direction at the commission, and my sort of advice, unsolicited advice would be, you know, you have a decision, man. I mean, if you think that the direction the Cape Cod Commission is headed in the right direction, then I think the appointment of Christie as acting director is a good one to make. If you think there needs to be a significant change in direction, that's the only time I think a nationwide search, quote unquote, might be necessary. In general, the Cape Cod Commission is a unique organization. It is very unlikely that you would find anyone with the kind of specific experience to sort of step in without a big learning curve.
Was that the 21st Century Commission you were talking about that made those recommendations?
Yeah.
He makes a good point. At the time, there were changes that needed to be made. Those don't necessarily exist now.
Are you still here, Mr. Ullman?
I am.
All right, watch what I'm going to do now. Can you please hand this over to your executive committee, Paul, on Thursday? Thank you. There's two copies there. And one more thing, Paul. Just for the record, I just want to state that I have a really good working relationship with the chairman of not only the executive committee, but the chairman of the Cape Cod Commission, so that I will continue to keep discussions back and forth, so he can keep me abreast of what's going on and where they feel they want to head, and then I certainly can, in turn, inform our commissioners of where we're going with it. So, thank you again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Good luck.
Thank you.
All right, we're going to go back to the agenda again now. I'm very sorry for jumping around here today, but some things just make necessary to do so. That brings us back to the agenda now, number 5, public hearings. I heard from the Health and Environment section that they will not be able to attend today, so I'm going to reschedule them. The reason being the extreme cold, and I guess we had to activate the emergency management committee and had some all kinds of problems with the cold weather. So that brings us right to number B, which is Children's Cove. Is there anyone here present that would like to address the commissioners in regards to the Children's Cove budget?
Good morning. Stacey Allegar, Director of Children's Cove. Just want to make sure we're working off the... You have the Munis packet?
I believe so, yes.
Okay.
We have this one, and we have this one here.
Okay. That's what I'm going to work.
You have the front one? That's just the salaries broken
down.
Yeah,
I have that. I just wanted to make sure you have the same thing in front of you. Thanks for your time today. I just want to start out by saying at the beginning of this budget season, we were asked as department heads to, especially Children's Cove, to start looking for ways to supplement our county budget at this point. So an opportunity had come to us as Children's Cove to apply for significant grant funding that we hadn't applied for in the past through the Victim of Crime Act, which specifically addresses and funds victim services. Most child advocacy centers in the state, actually, and throughout the country are funded through Victim of Crime Act grant funding. So it was a good opportunity, number one, in Massachusetts because the funding had increased. And we, as a child advocacy center, have a really good opportunity to receive that funding. So we're right in the middle of applying for that, and we utilize that opportunity in the hopes that as of March, we'll hear that we receive a significant grant to aid us in reducing some of the county costs. So if I can, I'd like to walk you backwards from page 9, just to clarify some of the things, because I think a lot of our budget's a little confusing. So on page 9 of the Munis packet, this fund 2797 shows the VOCA funding that we're applying for, and the bottom line being 198,536, which includes two salaried positions and fringes, as well as on page 8, you'll see $2,000 in the 2797-5276 line, which is software and hardware, and that is our client database in the amount of $2,000.
Which one is that again? 27?
On page 8, it's 2797.
Yep,
$2,000. With the bottom line for the grant being 198,536. You'll see on page 9 that our bottom line for our budget has increased to 822,464 on page 9, but that is due to Fringe's increased healthcare costs.
From the 735?
Yes.
To 822,464.
Yep. So from there, if there's no questions on that piece?
No, go ahead.
Okay.
Following with you.
So if I continue to walk you backwards on pages 5 and 7, and I try to do this every year because of our earmarks and grants, you'll see two earmarks, one for the SAIN and one for DCF. And those provide fundings for salaries for our SAIN coordinator, our administrative assistant, and my salary.
On page 7?
So page 6 is the DCF. I'm sorry. And page 5, I believe, is the SAIN.
Yeah, it's very top of the page. Right?
The grant?
It says total DSS.
So those are, right? Those are legislative earmarks.
The 94,230, 67.
Yep. SAIN is 5. Yep. And the total for the DCF is 140. On page 6. And then the remainder of...
Where'd you get the 140?
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
I got 94. You're adding 94. The 94,230 to the...
plus the fringes.
45,765 on the next page?
140.
Okay. I see.
So again, just clarification that these are legislative earmarks.
From Children's and Family?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then on page 8, you'll see in the middle, 2265299, $7,000, that's from the National Children's Alliance. That's an annual grant that we receive because we're accredited through the National Children's Alliance. So that tends to stay between $7,000 and $9,000. And then on page 7, on the bottom, you'll see 2076-5291. That's the Mass Children's Alliance. That's our state chapter. And that varies depending on their funding, but right now it's $35,000, and that's utilized for advertising for us.
When you say varies, does it vary a lot?
Last year it was 25. This year, you know, it depends on what funnels through. They funnel DPH funding.
In event you don't get the 35, do you just cut back down on your
advertising? We just cut back down. I mean, it'll always be there. It'll just be reduced. It's gone from like 21 to 35 over the past 10 years. Two more things I want to highlight, because the rest of my budget is pretty standard for what I might ask every year. On page 3, line 5438, which is professional liability. That's additional insurance that we had to get because it's called child abuse. I forgot the name of it. It was added to our liability insurance because of the procedures we have within Children's Cove. So it was added in the middle of...
$4,000, wow.
Last year, yeah. So it was six last year. I think the increase was up to 10 this year, so we added into our budget this year. And then on that same page on the bottom, 5499, there's a mistake because we're applying for the...
And the miscellaneous charges?
Yeah. So that number represents our database and our accreditation dues. That needs to be reduced by $2,000 because we're applying for that for the grant.
So that's going to be 500?
500.
You're applying for a grant?
So the $2,000 you saw from the Victim of Crime Act.
Oh, okay. That's so the grant's already in here
from,
under the income.
Yes,
okay,
yes.
That's what I need to know.
So 5499.
So we just crossed that up for 500?
Yeah, so we'll fix that. But otherwise, the rest of our budget line items are what we had requested from last year, for the most part. So our hope is to receive notice of the Victim of Crime Act grant by March.
Okay, I just think that we need to make sure that we make this public, and I think I already have mm-hmm. to some members of the Assembly. I'm not sure, I don't get to talk to my fellow commissioners, but we have to be aware of the fact that in the event you don't get grants that you expect to get as we move forward, at some point this may have to be either cut, which
amended, yeah.
mm-hmm.
or amended so that more okay. county funds get put in.
Right. We would ask the administration to hopefully provide supplemental funding for at least the 1 year to provide that. But
right. So we're looking at, and then basically what we're out on the hook for is about a couple hundred grand.
Right.
That I want to say we're on the hook for, but that's kind of out there looming in
right.
really good possible grants. But to do our due diligence as financial planners, we need to be aware of the fact that as we move forward, if we
yep.
don't get that money, come July 1st, we should be prepared to pony up that extra
right.
200 grand. But it also needs to be said, though, you haven't increased your budget by 200 grand. You basically have reduced it,
right.
as what I certainly have been an advocate for, because I don't want you to be continuing dependent, if you will, on county funds, because
mm-hmm.
quite frankly, it's becoming very tough for
right.
us to disperse that. So you've certainly done that in this, and you know, we just have to make sure that we're aware that if she doesn't get the grants, we have to advocate back.
So going on the, I'm probably taking a chance with it, going on the assumption that you're getting that you're going to get the grants that you've applied for, this $636,652, how much is coming from the county operations budget and how much is grants, roughly?
Well, you'd have to go back and go, that line item is added into this line
right.
item,
yeah.
so you'd have to really go back to this and just go back to the...
So we'll be reducing, if you look at it, if we receive that grant, you can look at the mental health coordinator and the family
okay.
advocate, those will be...
The 822 and the
yep.
636, okay. So the difference is what's in, the difference is the grants.
Yes.
So the 636 is county operating budget.
No, because the director position, the associate director, and the administrative assistant
right.
are partially funded by the DCF and SAIN grants.
My calculator is not working, but what you have to do is you have to take the bottom line here, which is 822,464.
Right.
You have to minus from that
right.
198,536, because that's the victimless crime one. But then you also have to go back and minus the $2,000, because that's another part of that grant.
Right.
You also have to minus the $7,000, which is a grant from the Alliance.
Okay.
Then you have to go back and minus the $3,500 for the advertising, because all that's included in that.
Yeah. But
then
if
you
you're
have to minus
just at
the $45,700 for the earmark that comes from the state, and then the $94,230 that comes also from the state,
right.
and that will give you what we are
gotcha.
Putting up.
Gotcha.
Get it all?
Yep. Got it.
And there was, I think there's one more too. Oh, the $2,000. No, that's already in there.
You said that.
That's already in there, right. So that's an exercise that, you know, we have to do when we get back and if we may, if you want to go back and make any changes or cuts or adjustments at that time.
But
it might be for to help people out in the future too, because your department runs so heavily on grants. It might be a nice exercise if you would maybe just yourself. I'm not going to look for Mary to do this, but add a little pencil line at the end saying, you know, by the way, if you subtract all these things, here's the actual county investment.
That's why I try to go through each of those earmarks, because I think they're confusing.
Right. I usually have my little calculator up here, and I do it every year, but my battery's just died, so.
I also just want to make a comment to say that I know there's been discussions in the community about Children's Cove funds being reduced. I do want to make a comment that the commissioners have been very supportive. We are looking for funding for our own sustainability as well. You know, we're doing this together. We're not operating in a silo, so I just want the public to know that we're supportive of looking for additional funding for Children's Cove as well. And the Victim of Crime Act grant is our first step in trying to do that, so.
We're just pushing you, though.
You're just pushing me. I'm trying to slow you down a little bit.
Anything else for Stace?
No.
Thank you, Stace.
Thank you.
Human services.
Yeah. Right with you. Next up, we have registry of deeds.
No, human services.
Human services.
Sorry, human services. Oh, my little notepad is wrong.
Sorry. Are they going to be in today?
No. Registry coming in today, Jack?
Thank you.
My own notes here, I had them switched back.
Good morning. I'm Beth Albert, I'm the Director of Human Services. So I'm here to present to you my request for fiscal 19. So what I have done is prepared for you a memo in which I've outlined information, particularly around our grants, because I know there's always questions about that.
Okay.
So I'll get started.
I was looking for a pencil, but okay. I'm going to go with the pen.
Yeah. So, first of all, there's no significant changes in our fiscal year 19 budget request compared to fiscal 18, other than the anticipated increases in health care and those types of costs. But other than that, there's no significant changes in the department's request. What I have laid out for you in number two is that grant funds support 40% of the department's...
Sorry. About to put it on vibrate. Sorry.
It's okay. Grant funds support 40% of the department's fiscal year 19 overall budget and 40% of the salary and fringe associated expenses, which are on the personnel schedule that you have. The department has 10 positions currently. 6 of these positions are supported with grant funds. 3 of the 6 are 100% grant funded. And those are our MOPSI, which is the Massachusetts Opioid Abuse Prevention Collaborative, our Substance Abuse Prevention Collaborative, and our Continuum of Care Program Manager are all 100% grant funded. The other positions, the SHINE Program Manager and the SHINE Data Entry position, are funded 65% with grant funds, and the Home Program Manager is funded, position is about 35% grant funded. In number 3, I gave you a little table which outlines the major grants. I call them major, but anything over $25,000 that will be expected to be administering in fiscal year 19. And how I laid it out is I gave you the fund number and the project number, the program name, the funder, the amount, the term, the status, if it's been projected or awarded, and then just some additional notes. So you'll notice that of the grants I have listed here that we anticipate administering in fiscal 19, all of them have been awarded, with the exception of the SHINE grant, which is projected. That grant is up for renewal on July 1st.
The 69 and the 25?
Just the 69.
Just the 69.
Mm-hmm. The 25 is something we've been getting pretty much on an annual basis from Cape Cod Healthcare, and they've already funded us through a portion of fiscal 19, and we'll be expecting that again.
So, in the event we don't get the 69 between now and June, what's your anticipation to do with that $69?
So in my continued comments, I go through each of the grants and kind of give you an update and my plan on what we're going to be doing. Just another thing about grant revenue that we bring into the county. This year, as in past years, we've been very successful in securing smaller grants that support special projects, and I just gave you a few examples. We have a $13,000 grant from the Bank of America that supports an overdose education prevention, some public service messaging, $17,000 grant again from Cape Cod Healthcare. They have a fund for substance use education to support substance use prevention, which was our My Choice Matters campaign. And we also received a $6,000 grant from the district attorney to support that same public service, public education campaign.
It'd be easier for me if I ask as we go
forward. Sure.
Do you mind?
Not at all.
Okay. When you talk about these smaller grants, mm-hmm. When the county establishes these new programs, and then I don't want to pick one out in particular because people will be calling me from
sure.
them, but we go ahead and we establish
a special revenue fund
yep. for these smaller programs.
Yes.
And in the event this funding doesn't come next year,
so they're not,
does that
yes,
program
so,
go away?
So they are time limited. They're not programs. They're projects within ongoing work. So, for example, we invested quite a bit of time and resources into a My Choice Matters public education campaign. We have limited dollars to advertise that campaign, to buy radio spots, and so we're always seeking additional funds to support the ongoing, for in this example, the public service announcements, the radio ads. So the program doesn't go away. We have My Choice Matters, we have a website, we have educational materials, but if we really want to saturate the market with this type of public health messaging, we need to get advertising dollars that are over and above. So I don't know if that answers your question. So the program doesn't go away, but the additional work we're able to do with additional funds will obviously decrease. So if we don't get one of these smaller grants for this targeted radio ad, I'll just use that as an example, we just won't do as many radio ads. So that's it. Okay.
It does. Obviously, my concerns are that when anyone, when it's not just the county, but any municipality creates whatever it is, a program, even a department, in some instances, we just saw a bunch of firemen have been hired in a community through a grant funding process. Mm-hmm. But when that grant money runs out, the community is on the hook for continuing it. And my concerns with a lot of the grant stuff, and I'm trying to wrestle my head around it, I quite frankly, I don't know how you do it, because that's all you guys do is deal with grants over there, and it's difficult.
Yes,
but my concern is that we do things through grants, and then when the grants go away, the county is faced with, you know, ponying up the money out of general funds, concerns me, because we don't have those general funds.
So in the case of these, many of these grants, they do pay a portion of salary. So if those grants end, and some of them they will end. You know, they're not a federal allocation, for example, like the home program, which may end. You know, any grant could end.
Any grant could end.
These are grant funded positions, and so the employment position will go away. Some of the benefits and the resources and what can be leveraged for years, but these employees are grant funded employees. So the decision about where the county invests if one of them leaves, or I mean if one of the grants is not refunded, is a decision that has to be made in line with whatever the strategic priorities are. So let me just run through these really quickly. So Prevention and Wellness Trust Fund. So this is an example of a grant that was originally a three-year grant. It was slated to end on June 30th. However, the grant term was extended for an additional 12-month period, ending 6/30. Future funding for Prevention and Wellness Trust Fund is uncertain at this time. So we act as the coordinating partner for the Barnstable County Partnership, which consists of the YMCA, Healthy Living Cape Cod, three of our community health centers, the Community Health Center of Cape Cod, Duffy Healthcare, and Harbor Community Health Centers. Through the good fortune of the Prevention and Wellness Trust Fund grant, we've been able to offset a portion of one of my county-funded positions, which is our senior project manager. So for the past 4 years, we've been able to offset 50% of her salary and fringe, in effect reimbursing the county for her work on the grant. Since 2014, so this is not a grant-funded position, this is a county-funded position. We've been able to reimburse the county for about half of her position over the last 4 years. Since 2014, the total amount of Prevention and Wellness Trust funds awarded to the partnership is over $5 million. Of that amount, $347,634 was paid to Barnstable County for coordination of the grant and administrative fees. So we don't know that the funding, future funding is uncertain. It was a trust fund that was set up insurance companies paid into it, and now it's in the legislature and they're looking for state dollars. So that's all I can tell you at this point.
Okay, but is since 2014, so we're in 2017 now, 14, 15, 16, 17, 3 years, just gonna run rough numbers here so mm-hmm. I understand the process. You quote that in that time since 2014 to the present, that the county mm-hmm. has received mm-hmm. as a credit, if you will, towards this employee that we already have, mm-hmm. about $110,000, $115,000 a year, to be credited to that person. Because you quote, you say $350,000 you got
right.
in here. So.
So I actually have a breakdown by year. So, you know, it was different every year, but it's...
I'm just trying to understand the process
yes,
more than the
that's
dollars.
That's the process. And this is a little different. Prevention and Wellness Trust Fund, because we used existing staff, I didn't hire grant-funded staff to run Prevention and Wellness Trust.
This is one that concerns me even more now, because if we don't get the Prevention and Wellness Trust Fund grant in FY19, mm-hmm. the county is going to be on the hook for an additional, or still for the hundred and something thousand for the salaries.
It's not additional because it's that position historically has been 100% grant, 100%
county
funded.
Anyhow.
So you'll see in my personnel line, the personnel line actually has gone down a little bit.
Okay.
So this is one that I'm actually, you know, we did not hire a grant funded position. We ran it out of our existing staff.
We're basically losing a customer. We were bringing in revenue mm-hmm. that we could put towards the general fund mm-hmm. that we're now losing that customer. We're not bringing in that $100,000 worth
right.
of revenue anymore.
And we also will not be putting effort into running that program or putting staff resources into it. So,
so can we cut down the hours of the staff that you've allocated to do that?
No, because she'll be picking up other things and taking on other.
She's multitasking.
So,
there you go. Okay. Did you have a question?
Yeah, it's all. I
reread what she described, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but within the last month or so, I remember under a commissioner's actions, there was some increased grant funding for the Prevention and Wellness Trust Fund.
Yeah, it's been a bit of a moving target because what happened
was. Some pretty big increases.
Right.
I
so what happened was, let me see. What's the simplest way? It basically they were carryover funds.
Yeah.
So they gave us. We had to do two budgets. One with a certain amount, and then they said, well, if we give you more, you know, you'll get more. And so because they gave us more money, essentially because they had some more in the pot to distribute to the existing Prevention and Wellness Trust Fund entities.
Right. And that goes into the extension that you're mentioning here to
yes.
June of 18?
Yes, okay. Yep, exactly. This has been a moving target. This has been a pretty challenging grant to manage because there has been so many different requests to amend contracts because of how the money has flown. And then they gave us more money, and then they gave us more money. So. The SHINE program is funded with federal dollars that are allocated to the region by the Massachusetts Executive Office of Elder Affairs. The executive office has announced that, in verbally anyways, that federal funding for SHINE may decrease in fiscal 19. We're closely following this and have already started working with a grant resource officer, resource development officer, to pursue local grants that could fill that gap if, in fact, SHINE funding will be decreased. They talked about a 10% decrease, but I have seen nothing in writing. It's all verbal. Nothing's confirmed. SHINE served over 7,000 Medicare beneficiaries across all 15 towns in 2017. The majority of those counseled in the program were over the age of 65. The total SHINE budget for fiscal 19 is $141,417, and the county's portion is $47,000. I will say SHINE is an extremely cost-effective program that leverages over 4,700 volunteer hours. The value of this volunteer time is estimated to be $112,000. And in addition, according to the most recent information released by the Executive Office of Elder Affairs, Cape Cod SHINE counselors saved county residents an average of $2,431 per client in reduced Medicare premium costs because of the counseling. And when you extrapolate that, it goes into the millions of dollars that we're saving county residents by giving them good advice on what Medicare plans to choose.
Can you just do me a favor for the record and the people at home? Can you just explain SHINE, the acronym,
sure.
and a little bit, I know what you said, how that we save money, but just a little bit of, really brief of what they do so people understand what we're talking about.
Absolutely. SHINE is serving the health insurance needs of everyone. It's a federal program. It's run across the country, and it supports counseling to Medicare beneficiaries. Anyone who has experience with Medicare understands how complex enrollment in Medicare is, and during open enrollment, when you can change your plan, there's so much information. The average person would find it challenging to make a decision without some good advice. So we have 70 volunteers across the Cape. They work at each of the councils on aging. And we also have satellite offices other places. I think we have 25 locations across the Cape. And so there are people who are highly trained, many times themselves, people who are Medicare beneficiaries, who do this volunteer counseling to their cohorts and advise them on enrolling in Medicare.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Do you have anything on SHINE?
No, she did a good job.
We also act as the collaborative applicant for the region's McKinney-Vento Continuum of Care application and program. And I know that there have been quite a few questions about this program, and I think it probably would make sense for me to come back at another time and talk about that program even more. But for today's purposes, I just wanted to outline, we currently receive three HUD Continuum of Care grants, the county department, one for planning and two for operating the coordinated entry system. With this grant funding, I was able to hire a full-time program manager in October 17, and that person is Martha Taylor, is responsible for fulfilling all the duties as the collaborative applicant. As the lead for the region's COC funding, our staff are responsible for establishing and monitoring a governance structure, appointing an HMIS, which is Homeless Management Information System lead, monitoring grantees, adopting a system and standards for prioritizing the most vulnerable chronically homeless, and establishing a coordinated entry system. The COC program is a highly regulated federal assistance program with myriad requirements, and I've actually noted the Federal Register because it's highly regulated. COC grantees contract directly with HUD and are subject to periodic program and fiscal audits. All proposals for COC funding are ranked and scored using a multi-factor analysis. Underperforming grantees are ranked lowest, and in recent histories, there have actually been grantees who are out of compliance that have been ineligible to apply for COC funding. In the previous three COC funding cycles, My staff and I have worked reallocating unspent dollars from grantees that have been reallocated to new or expansion projects. In federal fiscal year, our COC grant to the region totaled $1.7 million, should put an M there, and supports 145 permanent supportive housing units for chronically homeless households across the Cape. The federal fiscal year 17 COC awards have not yet been announced. We're expecting to hear any day, and it's about this, I think it's, it might be a little bit more than 1.7. I don't know the exact amount right now.
Those are done every 2 years?
It's done every year.
Okay.
It's one of those things we would love if they went to a multi-year funding cycle, because it's a huge lift to put in this consolidated collaborative application every year. Mm-hmm. And many of the projects are renewal projects, so it's quite a bit of work. Our investment is that we do hire a grant writer. We contract with a grant writer to help actually write the grant. Now that I have full-time staff, my hope is, as a cost-saving measure, is that she'll be able to assume that grant writing tasks, not this year, but next year. Again, because of the complexity of this program, it would be unfair to ask her to do that this year.
And that grant writing position that the county funds is not funded through the 1.7?
No, it's a contracted position that I have in my professional services line, so that is the county's investment. Yep. And that's, I think I budgeted $15,000 for that this year. I don't know if I'll use it all, but. And number seven
I want to go on a little bit. This has been.
Yes.
One that I need to understand, yeah, because I'm getting questions. A lot of questions on it.
Sure.
Can you explain to me what, I'm trying to be Bruton Farmer's language,
yep,
what is a collaborative applicant?
Okay.
Because that is what the county's duties are, number six still. It says the human services is the collaborative applicant. So.
So let me explain what that means. So the collaborative, so in order, just similar to the federal home program where we have a home consortium, one of the requirements that HUD has is that in order to apply for this money, there has to be an agency that's designated as the collaborative applicant. And that collaborative applicant is entitled to the planning grant. And in exchange for that, we actually work with the grantees. They actually complete applications on their own. We pull them all into a consolidated application that is submitted to HUD. It's much more complex than that, but in the simplest.
I need it in simple terms.
Okay, so that's simple. So we have.
There are people that think out there that the federal government gives the county $1.7 million.
No.
The county and the county staff decide where that $1.7 million goes.
And so.
But that's not the case.
No.
When we get the $1.7 million, it's because it's a cumulative
mm-hmm. yep.
grants coming in from people. You take all these grants, put them in a package, or these applications, I should say,
mm-hmm.
and say, here, government, this is what we're looking for. If the government says yes, you are bound to make sure that the applicants get it, not who you want to get it.
So I'll just add a couple. It's close.
Okay.
Are you a clearinghouse, basically? Or
no.
A little
the collaborative application is literally an application. The grantees contract directly with HUD. So the awards go directly to the grantees from HUD. They don't come through the county and we disperse. So in addition to being the collaborative applicant, we're also a grantee. We receive three grants. We receive the planning grant, and we received two smaller grants for coordinated entry.
So the $1.7 million is not necessarily funneled through you, it goes directly to the applicants,
yes,
from the feds?
Yes, with the exception, so we play two roles, I guess that's the easiest way. So yeah, we're the collaborative applicant and we're a grantee.
We don't have to be a grantee though. I mean, you choose to apply for a grant.
No, actually, in order, if you're the collaborative applicant,
you have to have a grant pending too.
You have to get the planning grant.
Okay.
Because HUD's giving us money to do this work. That's how it's happening. You know, they're allowing us, and they actually have a formula that they use. So they say, collaborative applicant, you're entitled to up to 3% of the annual renewal demand for planning. So that number changes year to year. So as the collaborative applicant, if we don't apply for it, we would be foolish, because we'd be leaving that money on the table, because nobody else can apply for it except the collaborative applicant. The coordinated entry system is a requirement. Up until 2 years ago, HUD did not even, there were no grants for coordinated entry. Because it's now a required component of a COC, we have applied for that and brought that money into the county and are actually operating a coordinated entry system.
What are you talking about for money in that? Just ballpark, under 20, over 20?
There's two different ones, hang on a minute. Let's see, one's 29, and then federal fiscal year 16, they allowed us to apply for an expansion grant, and so we asked for 55, which we got, and we're going to be using that money to expand coordinated entry. Expansion grants may not be available in future years, so we took the opportunity in the years that they offered it to get that money, because we're operating a coordinated entry system and we need to expand it. So I know there's a lot of questions about it. Tell you, because it is such a highly regulated program, HUD monitors the grantees. We, as the collaborative applicant, are also required to do site monitoring, and we do a lot of technical assistance in working with the grantees to make sure they're complying with the program requirements. Our role is extremely valuable because, one, if we didn't do such a good job in working with the grantees, the region may not get that money, which supports these very needed permanent supportive housing beds for people who are chronically homeless. I can do a whole cost-benefit analysis, which I didn't do for today's presentation, but I would like to come back with the new COC program manager and spend some additional time doing that with you, so that you understand
that.
Our investment and really how it benefits the region.
Right.
Yeah, it's very complicated.
How many, and again, just ballpark, so mm-hmm. I understand the procedure.
Yep.
How many grantees are there in this $1.7 million total package? Ballpark? 15, 10?
7 or 8.
Okay.
And some of them may have multiple projects.
And who are some of them? Just
Barnesville Housing Authority, Falmouth Housing Authority, Housing Assistance Corp, Duffy.
That's good. No, I don't even know everything.
I know I'm forgetting somebody.
Back to the work that we do, the effort that we put in mm-hmm. to be the collaborative applicant.
Mm-hmm.
Does the amount of money that we get as through the grant for planning and mm-hmm. entry, does that come close to covering the county's investment in this?
Those funds, the combination of those two, the coordinated entry dollars and the planning dollars, are being used to support this a grant, the COC program manager that I hired in October.
Okay.
Up to that time, I was doing the work, and we were paying our consultants to do, you know, some of that work. Again, because of the complexity and I think the efficiency and pulling that all into having one person being the boss of it, that's where we went in that direction, because it's too complex to have five different people working on various aspects of it. So I'm trying to pull it all in.
A key to the helping you do that, though, was the expansion grant, though, also, because yes. that's a substantial amount of money that
right.
went towards the, and I'm using layman's terms, but
yep.
the operations, if you will, of this collaborative applicant.
Right. And those are new funds that we're just going to be using. The grant just started, so
right.
we applied for it again.
Absolutely, I would like to put this on the agenda and have some further explanation.
Yep.
But I'm going to caution you way ahead of time. I don't really want to get into the weeds. I want to break it down for farmers to be able to understand how it works.
Mm-hmm.
You know, exactly, because I think when people say, why isn't the county taking that 1.7 and doing this
mm-hmm.
with it,
very specific
we
purpose.
Need to be able to tell them, because
yes.
that's not the process.
Yes.
Just like I corrected a member of the public earlier when he asked us to do something, told them, you're in the wrong place.
Mm-hmm.
This is kind of the same thing. The public needs to know
mm-hmm.
that we just can't take that $1.7 million and go build a homeless shelter somewhere, because we believe that's the right thing to do.
Exactly.
That is part of a collaborative application of 7 to 8 other organizations that have applied for it.
And the COC money is for very specific use and for very specific target populations, right. Chronically homeless.
Right. And we might want to just touch on the 24C, CFR, you know, 578. Again, real basic, real layman's terms, as you just said, you know, the chronically homeless.
Yeah, I think, be happy to do that. I think it's definitely time. I'm happy to always talk about COC because I know that there are a lot of questions.
I'm getting people calling me from different communities and different towns and asking me, and I feel bad because...
You can direct them to me, Leo.
Well, I know, and I tried to explain it, though, you know, again, and I don't mean this whatever, but sometimes we just have to break things down and explain them on the simplest terms to people, and then they understand, you know?
I think a diagram, and I'd be I think I'm pretty good at saying things in pretty simple,
Well, this has certainly helped me a lot this year, so.
Good.
Why don't we go right to 7 then, which
seven
is now
is
the
just the home allocation. I just wanted you to know that, you know, the amount varies from year to year. The federal fiscal award in 17 was $379,833. In 16, it was a little bit more, $394. And then in 15, it was $359. So it fluctuates a little bit. The county supports 65% of the staffing and program costs for a home. 35% is supported by the home grant because we are limited to 10% of whatever the allocation for Barnesville County is. We cannot, we only get 10% of it. Doesn't matter what it is, it's 10%. This is a change from previous years. We have started generating small amounts of program income, which is one of the things we wanted to do, from some monitoring. And we can also offset some of the program expenses like attorney fees and advertising if they're tied to a development. So we're on top of that. Anywhere we can get some, either generate some revenue or build the development, we've been doing that. So
my concerns with the home program are because of the grant allocation being only 10% of the money allocated.
The county's portion.
If in fact we enter a year where there are no funds allocated for the home program or a real, real small amount, mm-hmm. it actually costs the county quite a bit to maintain, I guess I'll use the term service, mm-hmm. the existing things that we've done in the previous years. I mean,
yes.
as you know, Ron, on our agendas from time to time, you'll hear me say we're going to discharge this mortgage. We're taking second place to have something
yes,
move forward.
On the mortgage. Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of things that are ongoing for operations of this program of previous funded stuff,
Absolutely.
And we have to make sure that we're aware of that because
yes.
we can't walk away from that duty.
No, we can't. We have monitoring responsibilities for these projects for a certain number of years,
yeah.
and then projects even going back in some cases 20 years.
Yeah.
And the county is, in order to be in compliance, will always be responsible for monitoring those. But for example, if the home funding goes away, you know, down to zero in future years, there's no allocation. We wouldn't be running a program, but we would still be responsible for monitoring.
Servicing
those previously funded
years.
Affordable housing. But right. So the balance is we've created affordable housing, which we need. But you're absolutely right. Yep,
yeah.
There is an ongoing responsibility.
I just wish we had set it up a little different ways so that we could always be assured that we were going to get some funding to continue the monitoring and continuing the servicing, if you will, of already outstanding obligations. But it's just the way it's the beast. So
when the home program got moved over to your department from the Cape Cod Commission, you had to assign this to did you have to hire a new part-time staff person?
So what we did was when this program was at the commission, I believe it was they had a one and a half staff positions
Paul
working
Luchinskis,
on it, or
I think
up,
was the
up
affordable
to two,
housing person,
and it was Michelle Springer.
Yeah.
And so when Paul retired, and then that year that the home program came over to our department,
We consolidated that into one program manager position, and then we contract out for the monitoring. So we have a program manager, Michelle Springer,
okay,
who works on this full-time, and her position is funded through a combination of home dollars and county dollars, and then we use, then we contract out to through a procurement process, yeah, for an organization that just does the monitoring that Leo was just talking about.
Yeah.
And then we also do some monitoring in-house, but it's nothing like it's so much more efficient to contract that service, yeah, out, because the company we use, this is all they do, so.
Good enough, thank you.
You're very welcome.
Your Munis packet is 17 pages long.
I know.
Yeah, okay.
I know. Look at my notes. I have all these,
yeah,
little tabs.
I know it. Do you want to go through anything? Actually, it's more. It's 20 pages. Do you want to go through some areas now? I always go for the large increases. Just to let you know how I usually
operate.
Well,
that's what I.
You know,
that's exactly.
Why does professional services going from $76,000 to $98,000?
Yep.
So if you want to take a minute and
yep, I'm prepared to address any of those. I mean,
okay,
I've gone through for each of them and noted where there was an increase and prepared to explain
why
it.
Why don't
you
do that so we're not asking questions that you've already prepared for?
So
and
given
then,
the complexity of this.
For the record, too, though, I mean, I certainly call you all the time when I have questions, and Ron can call you on his,
yes,
own. And certainly Mary Pat, by the way, who's watching this at home and got all these documents in front of her.
Okay.
If she decides to have any questions, she's very free to call you and have those answered. So
like I, when I started at my comments with you, I said there were no significant changes, and that's true. I mean, we could go through line by line by line,
no,
and there really aren't any.
Well, significant is relative.
One,
I think 20 grand is pretty significant, though.
Well, so let me explain that to you. So this one, I am prepared to respond to that.
So where are you on?
We are on page.
I'm on page one right now.
We are on page one.
The 98?
Yeah.
Yep, where this revised budget in 2018 was 76,788. So last year, I reduced that line by $40,000 because there was a need for departments to really see where there could be cost savings. And so I reduced that line because you'll see. So I reduced that line by $40,000. This year, it's up to. I did ask for 98. Because, and this goes back to the discussion we had about securing outside funds to pay for some of these like small projects, things like that. So I did put in $20,000 for things like some additional contracting to help us with the My Choice Matters public education campaign, things like that. The other professional services we use are pretty routine. We have a regional network coordinator, $40,000. I have a COC grant manager at $15,000, and we have a vendor that helps support our online resource directories. And so those have stayed consistent. I did put $20,000 back in from the $40,000 that was taken out last year because I anticipate needing some additional help. However, I will say, I am always looking for grant funds to pay for some of these things, and we'll continue to do that in fiscal 19. But if we don't budget it, I can't spend it, so to speak. So it's better to put it in than not put it in. I don't know how to.
that's the way you think.
Yeah,
I think
know.
The exact opposite. I think it's better off not to put it in and have you go get the grant. When you get the grant, then you can come and ask us, and we can always do a.
That's a good thing about having
the assembly meet,
yep,
every 2 weeks. You know,
yep,
we can always do a supplemental.
So that's pretty much the only. I think everything else stayed pretty much the same, with slight variation.
Can I ask you something?
Sure.
So. I was at a meeting with you a while back, and that the My Choice Matters program came up.
Mm-hmm.
You have, and if I recall, you received triple the funding that you actually went for originally, or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
It was more. That's the commercial. I think one of the commercials was a gentleman with the sheriff's department was,
yep,
telling parents,
yep,
to question their children, and it was,
yep,
really good.
Yeah, good.
And so, how much are you getting for that program in grant funding?
So that's more complex. So let me break it down. So we get a grant through the Mass, we get two grants through the Massachusetts Department of Public Health, the SAPC and the MOPC.
Uh-huh.
A portion of those pays for staff time, yeah, and a project specialist. And then there are other funds in those grants that we leverage. Some of them were used in the development of these public service campaigns.
Yeah.
Because this is an ongoing, we've invested in developing, and now we need to continue to look for funding to actually buy more radio ads. That's mm-hmm. the easiest example. And so that's where we get those. We ask for small grants. We got some money from Bank of America. We got some money from the DA. We got some money from Cape Cod Healthcare.
That
budget could be as big as I want it to be. Yeah. It really depends on how much ad time or, air time I want to buy.
So you don't necessarily have a fixed number in here for that program?
No.
Okay.
I don't. I don't have a line item for My Choice Matters. No, okay. I do not.
Just curious.
Yeah.
Thank you.
The other, another difference is actually on page 2. There was an increase in our, it's line 5279. Why is it 5279?
Yep.
Yeah, 5279, which was machine equipment maintenance repairs. The increase from 500, so you'll 3, see,
000.
Yeah, up to 3,500 was because of how we're paying for our copier now. And that has to do with the state contract. We are leasing it. But it's how they break out, the maintenance and the charges. We put it in this line. Out-of-state travel was the same. In-state travel was the same. Advertising.
Postage is up a little bit on page 4.
Postage is up a little bit, and I'll tell you why that is because we had heard that there's going to be changes to the campus postal service. So right now we depend on employee from the facilities to do interoffice mail and then also handle all of our mail, and we have been told, although it's not confirmed, that there may be a change in this, so I put in 500 extra in case we have to rent our own P.O. box. I don't know what the status of that is, but I didn't want to be caught short.
I think we'll be hearing that when we talk to the facilities, which actually run later on today, so maybe we can think of asking that, but I was under the impression that only had to do with state.
Again, it was not clear, and so I don't want to be,
okay,
because my budget is so close to the bone, if I don't put something in and I need to go rent a post box for a year, I don't have any money to do that if I don't put it in. Any other specific questions you had about increases or changes? Because I don't really note anything significant. Any significant changes? I mean, some things are, a couple dollars.
So your advertising went down by 3,500 or so?
What page are we on?
12 at the very bottom.
Page 12.
Add this.
Right, you're at 12.
So, okay. Let me explain this to you. So this is our SAPC grant, 2270. So we have a set amount for that grant, which is $100,000. So that's the budget envelope I work with. And so I have to work within that. And so if there's increases in anything else, something has to go down. And so in order to keep within that $100,000 budget envelope, I did decrease advertising because we had, increases in salary and fringe and all of those other things. So that's kind of that's the line I can flex a little bit.
Gotcha.
Can I ask you to go back to page 5? I know we're discussing and we have to keep on our radar, the retirement under 5981 section.
Mm-hmm.
Page 5?
Yeah, page 5. Is there an explanation for the going from 86, previous year was 82, and we're up to 106?
So we're on page 5.
Yeah.
5981 retirement.
Right.
I cannot explain those numbers. I mean, I can. Which one did you have? Retirement's based on.
Are you basing any of these figures on the early retirement request? Or are these based on just what our obligations are going to be for retirement?
I don't have anyone who's going to be retiring early.
Okay.
So the calculations were based on the percentage
that we were working. Did I ask you about
this, Mary, later on?
Okay, I'll ask Mary about it later on.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, there's some questions in the fringes too, so I'll also ask Mary on that too.
Some cuts here, so the bottom line is it comes out at only 4%.
Oh, thank you for pointing that out. You know, I did do the math on that.
Another one is the under the fringes, retirement on the page 5, and then on page 6 fringes.
Oh, from 306 to 2?
No, from the bottom line, 148 to 176. There's a lot to go through here, so I think, if you don't mind, in consideration of time, certainly let me and Ron.
So can I just point one thing out?
Please do.
Because I know the professional services is an area that you have
what page are we on?
Focused on page 2. And I actually made a note to myself here, is that it's not as... Even though I added more money into my request, which you noticed the difference between the 76 and the 98, the difference overall at the very bottom line is the difference between 161,750 and 157, which is only about, what, $4,000, because I reduced, thank you for pointing that up, reduced in some other areas.
What is that again?
First line item, they're talking about regular professional technical services.
Right.
And the bottom line
carried over to page 2.
On 2?
On page 2.
Although you increased the line before that, 5239, by 20 grand,
right.
Your overall increase is less than 20 grand. It's like 2 grand, a little bit more, 59.
Yeah. 4,000. About 4,000.
Yeah, about 4,000.
So I just wanted to point that out to you because I overlooked mentioning that and Jack pointed it out to me. Okay.
Yeah.
Please call me, if you have any other questions. Thank you very much.
I probably should have been doing this all along, and I apologize to the other department heads that have already presented in front of us, but it is my, plan, if you will, as the chair in putting these meetings together, to do the same thing that we did last year. Have this opportunity where the department heads come in, present their budgets along with Jack and... the finance director, Mary, here, allow the commissioners to take it. Then the county commissioners, I will be scheduling a budget workshop, if you will, for lack of a better explanation, where each individual commissioner will be able to bring forward any suggestions and cuts or additions they want to make. And then we'll be voting on a county commissioner's budget. So that I'm hoping to have 2 meetings into doing that. So the only thing I can ask, and certainly... don't really need you all back here, but if you watch during those meetings and there's a questions, you can call anybody on their cell phone, and I'll be happy to stop the meeting until you run over if you feel like you're not being treated fairly. I'm just trying to be fair to the department heads. They all can't be here every time we have a question, so I'm going to try to use our electronics so that if there is a question, we can get it answered before we vote, and vote not improperly, but vote without the full information.
Full information.
So, and why I mentioned it to you specifically is because you have a lot here. There's a lot in this as opposed to, you know, some of the others.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Good job.
So that was the human services, which is C. Now we're gonna go to D, which is the registry of deeds. And we have our registrar here.
Mr. Mead, should we congratulate you on a 30th anniversary?
I'm in the 30 years, yes.
Yes. Congratulations, sir.
Thank you. I was 7 when I started. Just
yes,
to
remember.
Boy, I look so good. Just kidding. Thank you, Ron. Commissioner Beattie, I appreciate that. The reminder.
I was trying to be polite.
I should have kept my mouth shut, right?
Old man in the room. What the hell? You did it now. So it's all
pretty good for a really old guy. Yeah, exactly.
Okay, how do you guys want to do this? You want to go down this sheet? You want to start with the one for the employment one first?
If there's well, any whatever on... whatever works for you all. I can. I mean, we're lower than we were last year. Overall, just to give you an overall picture, lower than our budget's gone down actually every year since 2011.
Yeah.
So we continue to do that, notwithstanding the fact that I think 2011 county budget was 23.3 and million, and now it's 28.5, and we're 9% of the county budget now as opposed to 12% then. So we've been trying to do that as a rule all the way through, notwithstanding obviously the increases in personnel costs, individual personnel costs, but we've been doing that by reducing the actual number of personnel over the years. And that's, at the end of the day, most of our budget is a personnel budget. I don't think we're much different than anyone else from that respect. But we have, this year we're, as I said, our net is, I think $1,000 lower, or whatever, 10, I can't remember what it was.
It's almost exactly 1,000.
Yeah.
To the penny, actually.
Yeah, and then last year.
2,659 to 2,658.
Yeah, yeah. The highlights are we have upticks in the...
this is the best worksheet for you to use with.
Oh, I can show stuff with the percentages. Percentages. They don't give me the good ones, right? mostly in terms of reducing... the increases are on the obviously on the personnel side, if there are any. There are increases on the personnel side, overall budget numbers. There's some sick bank buyback money plugged into there as well. And then on the other side, we're just really trying to keep the extraneous costs down as much as much
day-to-day operational costs.
Day-to-day operational costs. So,
your department has been a model, if you will, for I don't know if this is a good thing or a bad thing, but replacing personnel with computerized kind of things and new mechanisms.
Yeah.
I mean, over the years, really, when you go back and look at your budget, you can see how your personnel physically themselves, although the line item might be going up because of the fixed costs that we have no control over, but the physical personnel themselves, we've been as people have been leaving, whatever,
really
through retirement or other personal reasons, we've been able to kind of move forward and cover them with electronics. I don't know, again, if that's a good overall picture or not, but certainly it is with us. I mean, and I don't think we see an end to that either, do we? I mean, are going to be...
The state covers that, right? The technology...
Well, they help with some technology. Yes, if we can apply directly for funds that if we're updating, like we updated our mainframe, we got the money from the state.
Is it through the state treasurer's office? Or?
It's also through the legislature as well. What happens is we make a request to state IT and the Secretary of State's office. Okay. They have always assented to our requests. Then we submit that, those assents to the legislature, both branches of the legislature, and then knock on wood, a month later, they get 30 days to object. If they don't object, then the treasurer will issue a check to cover that. So that's basically what we've been doing. So some of our bigger IT purchases, when these one-off purchases that we've been trying to do, are from what they call the tech fund. Now the county registries have a different fund than the state registries, but it's basically $5 of the recording fee has been put into this fund over the years. We have to go up, unfortunately, and we've been trying to get it so it would be a permanent situation, but it continues to have a sunset provision built into the legislation. So effectively every 2 years we're going up and begging them to continue to keep this in place.
The tech fund.
The default position is the money would not go to us, or the fee wouldn't get reduced. It would just go to the general fund of the Commonwealth, which is where 90% of our funding goes, as you know. When we collect $75 for a recording, we keep 10 of it. It's the same $10 that the counties have been getting for almost 40 years now.
Isn't there legislation to increase that a certain amount?
Oh, there's always legislation to try to increase that. That's an annual filing.
Yeah. It doesn't go anywhere.
Well, I don't know. Some years, I was talking to a register the other day, one of the state registries, and he said he wouldn't be surprised if there was more concerted effort to, you know, from the legislature to consider an increase, because it's been since 2003 since the last time they did it. So they may be looking at it. Mm-hmm. I mean, the problem is, it's effectively, when it comes to at least the state registries, it's effective and an impact, unless the county gets to retain some of it, it's effectively just a tax, because if you're taking, you know, as I said, the $75 fee, we have surcharges of $25, which go to community preservation and the tech fund. But the balance of that money, $40 of it, effectively $40 of it goes to the state general fund. It doesn't go to the operation piece. So if they raise the fee, unless they, you know, allow the portion, the fee increase portion that's affecting that's in the county registries to stay with the counties, then it's, I certainly would be reluctant to advocate for a fee increase. I wouldn't be supportive of that in any event at the moment, but because you never know where that's going to go. But I mean, I would be more, I don't think it'll ever happen, but I'd love to see a greater portion of the fee that we currently collect would be retained by the county. But again, that's, the odds of that happening are slim and none.
And there's increases in other areas too. I think the community preservation fund is being the surcharge is being expanded or something.
Well, there's a bill pending. I think that's a very scary scenario. Yeah. Because it would be, as I understand the bill to read presently as proposed, it would allow the department, or it would basically cause the Department of Revenue to every year decide what the community preservation surcharge would be. So nobody would have any idea what the fee is going to be. And we have all these rules.
TRID, RESPA,
all these rules that are federally imposed relative to people trying to buy a house. And nobody knows what the fee is going to be. That would be in advance.
A logistical nightmare,
yes, exactly. But so I'm not entirely sure where that's going to go. But I do know, obviously, there's some pressure from a certain number of from certain areas to try to increase the matching funds available under community preservation. So the money's going to come from somewhere if it gets approved, and hopefully, you know, I do think the burden is placed pretty highly on sellers and buyers of property, so and deals in real estate. I'd like to think they would look at another.
Does that create any more of a burden on your department, or
no,
any increased workload?
No. That wouldn't affect much. But to Commissioner Kakunis's point, we are, you know, we are in the, hopefully in the next, within the next year, to be in a position. We currently, you're talking about technology, where we presently handle just a little over 30% of our recordings in what we call the recorded land section, which is our primary recording area, our e-filed recordings. So productivity on that end is significantly up there, and the land court has recently given the go-ahead for electronic recording in the land court end. So we're going to be implementing that, implement that this year. So that hopefully will allow us to continue that sort of that savings, that base, you know, number where we don't need more people. Even if we got busier, we'd be able to handle more through the electronic recording. One of the advantages of electronic recording is that the stuff comes in over the course of the day. There's a habit in the real estate industry where people come in, you know, they're in either the first thing in the morning, they come in at lunch, or they come in at near the end of the day, and so your timing is problematic in some ways. And so by having e-filing, that allows offices that do multiple transactions to be submitting those transactions to them to
throughout
us
the day.
Throughout the day as they're doing them, so it spreads the workload over a course of time. So that would be helpful again, and another way for us to keep at least at this point, the base level of bodies that we have without having to expand that in any way, shape, or form.
That was going to be my first question. For some reason, my notes said we had 28 employees last year. Are we down to 27 this year?
Yeah.
So this year's budget does reflect a reduction in one employee?
Yes, it does.
Correct.
Okay. That answers a lot of other questions I have.
On the land court side, the issue, certificates of title, I think, is in it?
Correct.
Is there like a, at one point, I think there was a procedure where they physically, everything was manually written to a certain, they had to enter the, make the entries manually. Do they still have to do that on the land court side?
No. One of the projects that we engaged in early, I know when I first came on here again, back in the dark ages, but I came in and we were years behind basically in issuing certificates. They were physically typed, and every time a new one was issued, you had to retype the information. So we have gone through a long process where we're, you know, as we've been computer entering these things so that they can just be recreated, you know, with just changing the names and the certificates. The hand entries have gone away. We're working away on trying to, except for in certain older certificates that you physically have to go in and but we rescan those into the system so that you can see them on the computer, but somebody might actually have to hand write something in on certain older certificates. But anything from 1991 forward, if there's a transfer of that certificate or an entry on any certificate from 1991 forward, it's all computer generated, so there's no more hand work on that stuff. One of the aspects of how things work is when there's a transfer or a sale of a property, a new certificate is created. So the old certificate, we're not going back to it. You know, it becomes just an archival record.
So another quick question: are you guys running out of space there, or all the books and everything?
Well, yeah. I mean, technically, yeah, we are. I mean, the reality is that we are. You know, we continue to have to produce record books, and we got to find room for them. We've been our next phase. We're hoping to be able to. We've been taking advantage of some space we have in the jail to place older records. We're going to do more of that as required. We need to produce the book. That's the statute.
So you're required. You have to have a physical record. You can't digitize everything.
Yes, I mean, right now, the statutes provide that we're supposed to produce a physical record book.
Yeah.
We are doing that. We're going to run out of shelf space. And we need, you know, you can fill the whole place with books and nobody would have a place to sit down. Mm-hmm. So we're right now storing the books that we have, and we're keeping them in the boxes, and we're
they're on the shelves.
But we're going to get to the point where we're going to have to put them
very
in
soon.
We're going to have to put them in the boxes. But we're looking to do some consolidation where we might. Right now, we're on two floors of that building that we're in. The land court is in the basement. Part of the basement level is us. I understand that the probate court may be moving into where the
facilities is up next. I'll ask them that question when it gets up here.
And
it's supposed to be done a month ago. So.
And we're looking to move up to.
That got them up there.
Yeah.
And we're looking maybe to move our land course up into the main level where our current copy and plan center is. Merge those departments in. And that would leave maybe the lower level where we are with the land court as more an area for more for storage in the short term. In the long term, with this area somewhere else to do it, we may be able to take that space and use it for something else.
More productive use.
Mm-hmm. But yes, to your point, the records, they keep on coming, so we got to keep producing books for them.
So how close are you guys to your, maybe I'm wrong, asking the wrong person, for your projections for what were being brought in? Does he do that?
I can probably speak to that. Taking a look at our numbers, we're off about 35,000 from last year's revenue. As you know, we had a very strong year last year. So we are ahead of our budgetary projections for FY 2018 through halfway through the year.
Notwithstanding that, we're still ahead.
We're still ahead. Right. Not with our projections, but I was speaking of what we took in last year. So if this holds up, we'll have a very strong FY 18.
But that goes to a point that I've been trying to make since I've been elected and sitting here right now, is we should not be doing projected revenues year. We brought in $100 last year, so this year let's project $100, but last year was an exceptionally good year. We should be budgeting and doing the budget process with a 5-year or 3-year look back, trying to get a good average of what we're bringing in. That's just good budgeting, but that's our job, not yours.
Well, we do take a look at those numbers, right, and talk with
that's how we put our budget together.
I mean, you use us as a sounding board for, right, you know, when the budget projections are being made, we're consulted,
right,
to say, does this make sense? Does, right, this work? You know, absolutely, does this work in the context, and how do you see it? So we're not saying this is what it's going to be. We're basically saying
it's
you're
just
nuts,
unfortunate,
or you're
though,
okay.
Some of the previous years, you guys weren't. Either, maybe you might have been consulted, but you weren't listened to, and there was some higher budgeted, projected incomes that were never going
to
be made.
When you're around for 30 years, they stop listening to you from time to time.
There you go.
So yeah, our numbers look good for this year.
I guess for reasons, because I want to say it, it's interesting that your line items just specifically for salary and wages has actually gone up, yet we've reduced it by one employee, and it has to be directly related to the rising costs of what it costs to have employees today.
Yeah, I mean,
things that we have no control over.
Well,
health costs.
We look at ways when we have people retire.
Right.
We look at ways. You know, Jack and I sit down and we discuss whether or not we're going to replace employee X, right, or we look at ways. How can we consolidate what we're doing? What can we do better with fewer people, if we can, right, and sometimes you can't.
Now, I noticed that, and I've always noticed it, but in your budget, especially in the Munis packets, it does separate land court from the regular registry of deeds, or I guess it's...
Yeah.
Yeah, registry of deeds is what it's...
It's traditionally been done that way.
Traditionally done that way.
Yeah.
But when you... Do you have employees that go cross back and forth, though?
Interestingly enough, at present, because of the way that our contract is negotiated, you are either classified as one or the other.
Okay.
Now, there are times that I do have employees in the land court that are capable of doing the recorded land work, and you know, we assign them as necessary.
Right.
If you have a day where
we can do a temporary transfer
just for the day, you know. But for the most part, never the two shall meet.
So, can I then ask what side the reduction of the employee came from? Was it the land court side, or was it the regular side? You remember?
Recorded land.
Okay. Thank you. Anything else for these guys?
Yeah, just to refresh my mind. So the union, do you deal with more than one union?
No.
United Auto Workers,
that's
is it?
Correct.
How does that fit in?
Well, I mean, before my time, that's when it started, but... unions are historically, they're aggressively trying to recruit where they can recruit, and I think that somebody had an in, obviously, or connection back in, 19...
It is what it is, right?
85 or whenever, when it started, and that's kind of where, So, I know they're in colleges, that union is...
Seems surprising.
Yeah, they could be Teamsters.
And as a side note to that, our agreement is up on the 30th of June this year.
Yeah.
So
you got to renegotiate.
Correct.
Thank you.
Do you have anything costs that you need to add into the FY19 budget for that negotiation? Do you foresee any things as far as sometimes we hire legal counsel that...
Well, typically, Register Mead and myself have handled the negotiations for the last, dozen years or so.
Yeah. So we don't see any problems there?
Not at this point.
Yeah.
Okay. No. Great. We've been doing it. Yeah. I've been doing it probably since I got here, basically.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, gentlemen, very much.
Long, long time.
I also will be asking you guys probably to come back and give us an update as we move forward so we can get a good projection on where we are in this FY17's budget.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sirs.
FY 18 budget, I should say.
So who's next?
Okay, facilities, you're up. Boy, I apologize. I didn't think this was going to take this long. I thought we'd be out of here. But a lot of you people want to talk about, I guess. Another one, you've got 20, just for the record, people will know you have 35 pages in Munis. So if you have areas that you want to highlight, it might be beneficial for you to go ahead and do that. If not, you certainly are available for us to call individually.
Yeah.
And certainly, again, I'll reach out to Mary Pat that's watching from home. If she has any questions, she can call you personally and get some clarifications as we move forward.
Yeah, I mean, I think if we go systematically, it's any increase or decrease. It was done by, there was a general decrease in some of the power lines. Just because the anticipated cost of power for last year, they were when we did the budget for this year, this current fiscal year, they were predicting a bigger increase, that which actually didn't happen. So that saved us some money there. So when we looked at it this year, we just looked at what they were anticipating for an increase or a decrease, and we fixed our numbers off of that. So straight all the way through, I mean, again, I think our biggest cost increase is, again, being probably the salary lines and the fringe benefits and the health insurance that goes through it. And then everything else is just, you know, pretty much a fixed cost. Keeping in mind that I actually don't have the breakdown in front of me, and I was thinking of it, I should have done it a little different way on the salary schedule. Majority of the salary schedule.
This one here you're looking for?
Yeah, I have the salary schedule in front of me. What I should do is the state reimbursement next to each one, just so you guys just know what the contribution from the state is, and I will do that for you, and I'll get that over to you. I didn't think of it until just now when I was looking at it.
And when we do that calculations for reimbursement, it also includes the increases and all personnel costs,
right,
including health care.
Absolutely.
And
yes. So in the last kind of 2 years, maybe 3 years, we were able to increase all the buildings with the exception of registry of deeds. But that is to be coming, hopefully in 19, that we'll have an increase in that one.
Hopefully in 19?
Yeah. Well, it depends on the DCAM lease, how it works out.
It's going to be in 18.
No, the 19, it's the lease.
I know, you will see the benefit,
right,
in 19.
Right. So, second district, we finally got up to 100%. So any costs associated with second district, we get reimbursed 100%. It used to be 96%. It was 93, then 95, then it went back down to 93, and we got it up to 100. Typically, the state doesn't reimburse for elevators. The actual square footage of elevators or boiler rooms, but we're able to negotiate it with them.
That's so you're already getting reimbursed for the Assembly of Delegates chambers?
In 19, we will.
No, this year I got it.
Oh, really?
The Assembly, yeah. But that's where we're at on those particular buildings. I mean, unless you guys have any questions, it's pretty straightforward. There's no...
Can you just, without getting into the weeds of it, can you bring us up to speed, especially since, again, Commissioner Beattie and I don't get a chance to talk to each other on the mail issue and the mail question? We had a department head here before you that was added some money into their budget because they were concerned about the mail distribution. I know currently I'll let you go ahead and get into that a little bit.
We had a full-time mail clerk. And over the years, the mail has decreased. Yeah, with Dave Murphy going digital, and their group going digital, primarily, like we lost, you know, probably 2,000 pieces of mail a month that we didn't have to process anymore. When Dave, the more digital everyone goes, the less mail we process. In the state's ultimate direction is they've taken over their own mail. They have their own mail meters now. We used to do it for the state too, as a combined unit. So eventually the state's not going to reimburse us for the mail clerk position anymore. So in anticipation of that, we are starting to look at potentially not having a full-time mail clerk for FY19. But we're still trying to work out the logistics of that.
Not having that full-time mail clerk, though, is that going to impact? I know it's because we don't need it anymore because of the state's requirements, but certainly our department heads, like Beth was in front of us, should she be looking at then having in her budget monies for either her own P.O. box and
I have it coming to my budget currently for the P.O. box. And I'm glad that people, we haven't really discussed it openly yet because we're still not sure what the position is in the state on it. And I'm trying to get better intel on that.
But you're budgeting to take care of our staff.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, if there's an issue, like for the first year, you know, we have it in place. There are some questions of retirement for the current mail to, the mail clerk right now. And so going forward, you know, we're just trying to anticipate a few kind of things up in the air and that I don't have a definite answer on yet. But right now, we are capable of continuing the mail the way it is. And then we have some other alternative plans that we're reviewing right now to see which one is going to work best for everyone. But I would say that starting July 19, we will not get reimbursed from the state for the mail clerk.
So for the mail clerk, is that somebody that's located in the basement of the district court or something like that? And then you give it to one of your staff?
Because the mail clerk runs around now.
That's the young gentleman. He drives around in the buggy with the...
He fills in from time to time.
Okay, because I know him and I've seen him.
So there is one guy dedicated to doing just the mail, and as the mail has decreased, he's also stepped up and he's done, especially in the spring and fall. He puts all the flowers around the campus. You'll see him watering. He does a lot of like the kind of day to day maintenance because the mail has really kind of decreased. So he's kind of stepped up and done other like area beautification projects for us.
Yeah.
But if the mail is going to get so low that I'm not going to justify a position of a full-time position to have to find work for them, especially.
So they do other stuff.
Right.
Why couldn't we, and again, I know FY19 is covered, but you're looking at, you know, FY20, I guess, is when all this will come to effect, that we have to have a new kind of a mail system, if you will.
Right.
Why couldn't we just have a one mailing address for any county department? P.O. box, this address right here, what is it, 3195 Main Street.
Yeah, so Dave Eaton.
And then put a mailbox is out there. Someone.
I don't think they'll deliver it.
No, if they deliver it to us.
Right. No, exactly. Yeah, that's so.
Owen's got nothing to do. Owen sits there, takes the mail and goes over there and puts it in everybody's box.
There's Dave, the current mailer.
427, I thought we had a P.O. box at Lowell County.
We have multiple P.O. boxes. We have multiple P.O. boxes, we have multiple street addresses. So it's just trying to combine it and see what the best effort is. And the other piece of it is like someone like Beth, all of her address information is already printed on her forms. So it's going to be a slow process to get it over to a newer system. So we're just trying to baby step it in and figure out which is going to work the best way.
Again, I guess that's where I'm going with having just, do we get mail here delivered here to this building? No. They will not deliver to this building. Okay. So if we just had one overall P.O. box for the county, all of the county,
right.
One P.O. box, and someone went there every day,
right.
Brought all the mail here to this building, there's no reason why we couldn't have sweet boxes out there. I can't call them P.O. boxes because they're not. But Beth would come here
right.
And get her mail
right.
Out
so
of her suite number 5 or whatever.
Right, and that's, you know, one of the possibilities we're looking at. And then the other possibility of that is, you know, we could send, you know, one guy from the facility staff once a day and just drop like a bulk thing off, and we just wouldn't be handling like your mail going out. We would mail just the mail coming in, coming to us, you know. Like we could make it so it's just, you know, workable within the department. But a majority of these mailers and things that you get printed up now, like the company that's printing them can print your, you know, postage right onto them and you just pay up front for it. It's just an added cost and then we pass the savings on that way. So we're not physically touching it again.
And you're going to give us a breakdown of the state reimbursement for some of these things?
Yeah, I should have done it. I thought of it when I was sitting
there. Because that's pretty important. Yeah. Okay, thanks.
I think we're all set. I guess. I'm only on page 16, is 35, but you know.
He's supposed to tell us about the dredge, but you want to do that later?
No, he's doing that later. I gotta get rid of my, what do you call it here? Thank you, and I know this again is, you're gonna get some calls on this too. Did you get a copy of that? 35 pages. I want your opinion on all those line items. Okay, that brings us to F, our final discussion here on finances and the budget, which is the Assembly of Delegates. And we have here the Speaker of the Assembly. We have here Mr. Ullman, who...
I'm the Finance Committee.
Finance Committee member. Used to be chair, but now is not. had to take, I took that thing for you, Ron.
Yeah, yeah.
Here's the chair, John.
Okay.
And the clerk.
And the clerk, I'm very sorry.
I know you like gifts, and I think you're kind of collecting these characters, so.
I love these characters, thank you, look at that. That's a pen, though. Wow, they're good at that.
Can also use that on an iPad, too, it's got a soft tip.
Yeah.
Good guy, but thank you.
You're welcome.
See, department heads? Gifts.
Presents.
Gifts.
What is it, the green one?
Yeah. I don't care, I like gifts. I'm proud to say it, too.
Nice quirky things.
All right, I'm gonna use it now, just to show you how much I appreciate it. Here we go.
Good morning, good afternoon.
Pretty cut and dry, you're,
Well, I'd like to give you a little background, a little information.
Sure, please, whatever you'd like to go for us, yeah.
You know, we received the guidelines and the directives that were put forward by the commissioners, and admittedly, we are a cost center for the county, but unlike other departments, we don't provide necessarily any services, we don't receive any grants, so we proposed the approximately 17 guidelines that the commissioners established. And there was one in particular that we were able to zero in on, and I believe that was number 14, where you were requesting for departments to take a look at their budgets and where they could make cutbacks to do so in the event that you needed to do that in order to come in at your targeted budget figure. So with that in mind, I'm more than happy to run down the list that you have before you of the items contained in our budget. Admittedly, there aren't very many, but it won't take very long, I guess, to go through them individually. The first one that you see is related to salaries, and that obviously represents the 15 delegates and the clerk, the assembly clerk, and also a combination position as the clerk for the regional government. And this year, the figure has remained fairly stable, due in large part to the fact that the directive that we received was to take a look at merit in FY19 not exceeding 2% versus the 4% that it is budgeted for in FY18. And that is reflected in the number that you see there. Currently, the clerk for the Assembly of Delegates is at the top of the labor grade that the clerk is placed into, so there is no there are no steps reflected in this particular category for the clerk. It's strictly COLA.
And the assemblies are straight $1,000.
Correct. So right. No, for 15 members.
There's no what do you call it, COLA or.
Nope. Right, not for delegates,
right.
Not for delegates. The next item is professional services. That has remained stable from year to year. That may vary slightly due to the fact that there were some.
Okay, stop just for a minute. Why did we take $1,000 off the telephone?
Well, the telephone reduction that you're seeing there, I was going to get that to that in the end, but I'll go over it now. The reduction that you're seeing in telephone is a direct result of the elimination of the fax line for the Assembly of Delegates. The reality is, you're looking for efficiency, that's one straightforward place where you can become a lot more efficient, as far as the Assembly of Delegates is concerned. I can tell you that probably within the last 12 months, and has been the case over the last several years, I don't think I get two faxes a year from the public.
Okay.
What I get is offers to pave the driveway, re-roof the roof, take trips to Cancun. It's a waste of money. Now people are scanning an email.
Family, yeah.
Yeah. I know, but not on the county dime, absolutely not. So that's a direct reflection of eliminating that Verizon bill every month that we pay. Professional services, again, from time to time, depending upon how much either the commissioners talk or the assembly talks, the cost for professional services may increase or decrease because it's a direct reflection on the stenographer, the cost of having the stenographer present.
That's 15.
And we went down that road last year.
Yes, we did.
Only thing that came to light this year, though, which is a little different, is the state has ruled that the stenographer's report or what do you term that thing again?
It's a transcript.
Yeah. Oh, the transcript is not accepted by the state as minutes.
Right, but you'll see that in the transcript,
really?
There are now summary categories in there. There is a summarization.
We
adjusted and adapted that. But for the benefit of the public, they also get to see the details.
There are some of us still that don't believe that a $15,000 expense is warranted just so we can have a written version of what's already on tape, already put on our county website, already filed, if you will, video-wise, so people can watch the whole meeting.
If they didn't have that, the video's not, they would still have to have minutes.
They still have to have minutes anyhow, written with the minutes. 1570. Yeah. They have to have written minutes.
Wouldn't it be great if they just accepted videos?
Yeah,
that would be
don't.
Great, right.
It'd be probably great if they would accept the journal, but they don't.
She
just said that they addressed that.
No, they addressed it by them doing a summary of what happened in the meeting and now actually creating minutes.
They
still have the journal, though.
Okay.
Yes, but the summary is contained within the journal.
The journal is a great thing, don't get me wrong.
The summary, so
but it's a $15,750 expenditure that, quite frankly, I don't think the benefit weighs the pros.
So I have a question. So the summary is done by you based on the journal? Based on the transcript?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes. And again, that's a decision for you and the assembly ultimately to make. Education of employees, that's the next category, budget category. That directly reflects any conference registrations or workshops that the assembly attends.
So is MMA included in that line, or is it included in the in-state travel line only?
The registration for MMA. Yeah. Is contained in that line.
Wait a minute. So the education of employees.
The registration.
5241. Is $2,400?
Correct.
That's it?
That's the registration.
That's just for the registration only though. That's not for the hotel. It's not for the meals.
Okay.
It's not for the travel back and forth.
Correct.
That's registration to attend the MMA meeting.
The breakdown, if you wanted me to give you a little bit more detail on that, the breakdown would reflect approximately 10 delegates at the basic registration costs, and then a little bit more to accommodate for, because they have meal events that they can go to, or any other workshops that delegates may come forward with that they feel would be good professional development for them that they may need to attend. It has happened from time to time.
The only question I have on it, and I would appreciate a copy of the breakdown if you have it, just for my own packets, but the only question I would have is, what portion of the $2,400 that you have budgeted here is not at all in any way related to MMA? Are there other educational, educational of employees expenditures other than MMA?
Yes and no. And here's why yes and no. The lion's share of it is definitely MMA. Where the fluctuation may come in, I've allowed $55 or $60 per individual of the 10 for meal allowances. You know, those meal events are $45,
again, $50. You're talking MMA.
Correct, but not everyone attends the meals.
I'm asking you a question.
All right.
Out of the $2,400, is there anything that you're budgeting in there for any other educational thing that a member of the Assembly of Delegates would attend that has nothing at all to do with MMA?
Well, I'm going to tell you that I can't specifically answer that, because if someone does not want to take the meals and they come to me in August and say, I'd like to go to this event, there may be money in that budget line to be able to allow them to take that workshop. And that would be coming out
Have
of...
Have you had experience in the past that members of the Assembly of Delegates have asked you for money to attend educational things that cost money that has not affiliated for the January MMA annual meeting?
Yes, I have. In my tenure here, I have.
And ballpark figure, $100, $50?
Couple hundred dollars.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, next.
Next item, copy machine maintenance. Pretty cut and dry. I don't think I've had a year where it has exceeded $350. But again, it fluctuates based on the number of copies, and that's a pretty much a maintenance contract, and then they add on for the number of copies that which
you own the copy you have, you don't lease it, or you do lease it?
No, we own it. We own it. So this is a maintenance contract, and we own the machine. The next item is the in-state travel. That reflects mileage for all delegates coming to and from assembly meetings, committee meetings, other meetings that are authorized or part of their professional development, including things like the MMA conference. It also includes conference accommodations. Any accommodation that is approved or authorized for a delegate to attend would get reimbursed through that line. Parking, mileage to and from those types of activities, that's what's reflected in that line. And,
do you have a breakdown of that by any chance?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe could you supply us with that? I appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Especially the taking out of what you're anticipating for the mileage of the delegates to and from delegate meetings.
Right. Just the delegate meetings, and not even counting committee meetings, because that fluctuates.
Right.
If every delegate came to every meeting for the 24 meetings that they have a year, approximately, not including committee meetings, it would be about $8,000.
Okay. And if you have a breakdown of that, I'd appreciate it.
Out of the 17.5?
Yes. And the rest is the balance attributed to approximately 10 delegates that attend the MMA or any other conference that would require overnight accommodation.
Right.
I haven't had that happen for anything other than the MMA, but that's what that line carries. The next item is the legal notices. Again, something that can fluctuate depending upon the number of proposed ordinances and other legal notices that the assembly wishes to post and advertise. Now that's one, if you could get the state to agree to allowing us to use our website as the official posting place for legal notices, we may be able to eliminate a cost for advertising in newspapers.
I don't think they've done that yet, have they? Do you know?
No.
Suzanne, if they've done
I don't think they haven't.
Because I know with the town of Howard, we still have to take legal notices, especially the Conservation Commission hearings, Board of Health hearings, within the newspaper.
And as the newspapers start to become less relevant, I don't know if that might be something that will jumpstart the ability to post on the website. That would be great for somebody to take that course.
Could you change your statement by not saying less relevant?
Print, I should say print.
Very, very relevant.
I should say print.
They
newspapers.
They are the backbone of
print
the country,
newspapers.
And we need more newspapers and more reporters.
I'm just saying, as someone who's
right behind you.
I'm just saying, as someone who loves to hold their newspaper.
He's in striking distance.
I love my print newspaper, but I am in the minority. A lot of people are far more electronic.
That's enough. He's got his hand down now. I just saw him with his hand on something over there. I don't know what.
Okay, the next item would be the unanticipated or miscellaneous contractual. These are for incidental things that come about that we have no control over, could not possibly have planned or foreseen in the budget process, and I have reduced that. I've reduced it from 1,000 to 500. I guess I'd like to ask while I'm sitting here if maybe you guys could do us a favor and take 200 of that and put it up into printing and copying, because I forgot.
Yeah, I was going to ask you why you don't even have the 150 in there anymore.
Well, because I forgot. I took it out and forgot that that's where I get my books bound.
Yeah.
When I need to bind the assembly journals and the laws, that's the line that I should be using. This year I tried to use miscellaneous contractual and
I got my
hand slapped on that. So if you could move that around.
I'm just going to add 200 to that as a...
Okay.
What do you call it? We'll do that when we have our discussions. But make sure, and certainly if we forget to do it and the assembly gets it, it's a minor addition. But
all right. Postage, I've reduced that. We do a lot of things electronically now, and I think $150 would be sufficient to cover the cost of miscellaneous mailings that the assembly has from time to time. Office supplies, and also the next line, miscellaneous supplies. I've totally reduced that. I'm sticking with $600 for office supplies, and scooping up all the free pens I can anywhere I go, so we don't have to buy any. And I think we should be able to do it. shouldn't be a problem. Association dues, that increased this year because we find that we're having more delegates attend the Cape Cod Selectmen and Counselors Association meetings, and whereas previously we had a standing membership of three, they're finding that there are four and more attending their meetings. So they have to cover those costs, and they've asked for us to increase our membership dues related to that, and so we're now going to budget four people at $40. And that's what...
Which line item is that? I'm sorry.
That's going to be association dues.
On page three.
On page three, sorry.
And the last one that I eliminated was the newspaper. I had budgeted to have the Cape Cod Times delivered to the assembly. It was never really a good practical idea, you know, to toss the paper outside of the courthouse and me to hope that it's there when I get there. Doesn't work, so I just bring my own in. That's good enough. And then after that, we just simply fall down to the area of retirement, group insurance, and Medicare. Retirement and Medicare is strictly related to the clerk. We were asked to increase our retirement by 5.28% and the group insurance by 10%. It does reflect a reduction this year over last year, and that's in large part, it's due to either individuals who have chosen different plans, selection. It's all about selection. So that has changed. So to just quickly recap, our FY proposed 19 budget over 18 is approximately $9,000 less than last year. And if you look at where our FY 17 closed, we were able to turn back approximately $9,000 to the county. And I know that goes a long way with helping your, you know, your fund balance. And that's where we're at.
Good.
I mean,
that's where Do you have any questions?
Yeah, on group insurance. Mm-hmm. That's not. You said something is just for the retirement's just for the clerk, but the group
right.
insurance is for everybody, right?
Correct. Delegates have the opportunity to select health insurance, and currently, I think we have seven delegates that. Take health insurance. Some only take dental. Some it's
if
just the life insurance.
If That's you're it. Contemplating, and certainly when we have our deliberations, if you're contemplating removing the Assembly of Delegates members to be qualified to get insurance.
I wasn't, but...
Okay. Well, I mean, we have the discussion every year, so I just will let you know that you can only do that effective January 1st of FY19, so you're not going to see a reduction of, and I'm only using rough figures here, let's say it's 150,000 of this 173 is allocated to the assembly participants. Mm. You would only be able to reduce the FY19 budget by 75,000 because we are still obligated to carry their insurance until January 1st. When the new elected assembly will take over on December 31st, and the new assembly that gets elected in November takes over in January.
Right.
So, because right now the current people who have run with the, and who are sitting there, are under the anticipation that they get this benefit. So if we do change it, it will not take effect until January.
It actually was much less than I thought it would was.
The discussion always comes up because there is a discussion of fairness when you have assembly members who don't take the insurance, who are only getting $1,000 a year, as compared to those assembly members who do get the insurance. Some of them get the family plan, and you could argue that they're getting $38,000 a year.
Right.
So. It's just a discussion that we do have, and I want to make sure that...
No, what I had in my mind is, I don't know, maybe 5 years ago, four or five years ago, I met with Mary Pat, and the lady who's, she was assistant town, or county administrator at the time, but now she's head of Cape Light Compact.
Maggie,
so anyway,
yeah.
Maggie.
Maggie, the figure that was thrown around to me at that time, there was a lot of... there was a lot of things going on, issues, and they threw around 300 somewhat thousand.
Yeah. 263 is
so,
the highest number
yeah,
I think
so,
we've ever had to
like
actually
I said,
pay, and
this
is
much
being
less,
budgeted
so,
at 173.
Sorry.
I mean, I'm sorry, 163.
Yeah.
163 was the number that was the highest that I've ever seen if it's been here, and this is being
budgeted at 173. Yep. Again, our clerk is included in that. Yep. We have to take out.
Yep.
Because we're definitely going to offer them insurance. Okay, the only other thing I would just want to say to you guys is that, first of all, thank you for the presentation. There is going to be some discussion on this particular budget. There is maybe a proposal coming forward that we will actually be separating the two positions of the Assembly Clerk and the Clerk of Barnstable County. Presently, they are being occupied by the same individual. But I do believe, and I know for a fact, that when we do our deliberations, that there will be a proposal coming forward to actually separate those two positions and probably reducing the number of hours allocated to the Assembly of Clerks position. Again, I look forward to having that discussion, but it won't be today. But I just want to make sure
you guys... let us know when you're going...
Absolutely.
Oh, we can check the agenda.
You'll see the agenda, okay. And when we go into the general, what I will probably determine as the budget workshop amongst the commissioners, where the commissioners will be able to bring forward their recommendations at that time for the commissioners' vote, either support or not support. That's probably the time it'll be presented. In the meantime, I'll be happy to work with you, Madam Speaker, as to my ideas and where I'm going to be bringing forward some suggestions. And I think... You know, this is not blindsiding our employee by any chance, and I want to make sure that when we do these discussions, we do them for the positions, not the employee. Certainly, taking into consideration though that there is a current employee in the position, so we have to be careful.
Are the commissioners still on track? Do you think at this point with submitting the budget to the Assembly on February 7th?
Yes.
That's right.
Yep.
Capital.
Capital on this in January?
17th, January?
Why don't you guys ask Mary on the way out? Because okay. Mary is the one that's going to be behind that. I'm getting nods in the room, but okay. I do not see a problem with
it. And the reason that I'm asking is...
yeah, you need the schedule.
Absolutely. Department heads and everybody really appreciate as much heads up as they can
I'm
get,
I'm
going right?
to do my best to stay to it, just as I did last year. This will be my second year at it, so hopefully I'll get it to you as I did last year.
Okay, that would be great.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah.
All right.
Here's that.
1-12-20. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Let's go. Oh, yeah, we're going to go quick, all right?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you all. Thank you very much to my department heads for coming in. I should say our department heads, so I don't get yelled at by the Assembly. They're not my department heads, they're our department heads for coming in and doing this presentation. And we look forward to moving forward on the budget. With that, Ron, I'm going to go to number 6, which is the approval of minutes. I'll be looking for someone to move the approval of the minutes of the regular session of January 2nd, 2018, as presented.
So moved.
Been moved. I'll second it. All those in favor?
Aye.
Special meeting of January 2nd, 2018. I'm going to summon the move to approve the minutes of the special meeting of January 2nd, 2018 as presented.
So moved.
I'll second it. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, now we're going to go to general business.
We did A.
Following this down here.
We did A.
Okay, so A has been done. I did say, and I'm going to have it included in the record, that the chair, I did attend the executive committee meeting of the Cape Cod Commission this past Monday. In which Mr. Nikritsky did the same presentation he did to us today. And I just want to let you know that I will be in contact with the chair of the Cape Cod Commission to make sure that we keep us advised as anything as we move forward on this issue. So with that said, that brings us for update on the status of the new dredge. Where is it? How is it? When are we going to get it? Is it working yet? Has the head been installed? Has the head been installed? Let me ask you that for us.
No.
Okay. The head's been approved. It's been checked.
It's been fluxed. It's on its way. It's going to be installed Thursday.
Okay.
The hydraulics are all working. The new hydraulic system is all working.
Is it still electronic, an electronic over hydraulic?
But it has the bypass valves in it now.
Right.
So basically what they did was they took it from, it still has the same high-tech setup in the front end of it.
Right.
And then what they did was they simplified the back end of it so we have manual overrides for everything,
okay.
Which is a better system to begin with.
In case the electronics go down,
right.
We have manual overrides.
Right. So there's manual overrides into it. So it can be operated both ways. It can be operated manually or electronically. So that's the ideal situation for us. They have had a few problems with weather, obviously. Like, even as you know, they were filling the hydraulic fluid the other day. They were torching it to get it to go in because it wasn't flowing at minus five.
You know, and this...
And they have a worse situation than we do here as far as the weather and the icing.
Right.
They had the snow and then they got the water on top of it. So they're really... I'm really kind of impressed with their effort this time, excuse me, this time around on trying to get this boat working. The conditions they've been working in to get this going, and they have been there every day working on it. So I am impressed. The only hesitation that I do have now going forward with it is once they get everything in place is when we go to do the actual testing on it, before we sign off on the acceptance of the dredge, it might be further out in January or if not in February. Solely because of locations that are iced over right now. I know we're getting a warm spell Friday, but it looks like it's going to dump again in the middle of next week. Right now we're in Bass River. We can't get to the barge. The barge is completely iced in.
I heard about that. People have asked me about it. So it's frozen right in the ice?
It's frozen in the ice.
What, thick or something?
It's about 6 inches. When I was out there Sunday, it was about 6 inches. Yeah. Yesterday they were out working on the dredge, just freeing up, you know, keeping everything winterized and making sure how everything's moving. When I caught up with the gentlemen that were working on it, them coming back in on their skiffs, it was like a half hour ordeal just to move the icebergs around. So once we get a break in the weather, the intention is to move it to P-Town because that's our next job that we're going to. But it's a matter of, you know, usually they'd run through the canal and then go down. But the canal, as of, I think, last night, it was still at icebergs floating in it. So, you know, it becomes a safety issue. So
the canal?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's blocked right up.
All we're doing, though, is just making sure that prior to we taking full 100% ownership of this vehicle, we will run it through its tests.
Absolutely.
Whether that takes until March to do because we have 6 feet of ice or not.
The other reason why I agree with you 100%. Okay. The other reason why I bring it up, Leo, is because I told you that they're shooting for the 15th.
We thought we could get it into the Allen's Harbor, but
I believe they could have this thing together and operational by the 15th, but I'm not taking custody of it until I can see it run in.
And like I said, you and I said we had talked maybe we could get it into Allen's Harbor, but that's not going to happen.
Yeah, there's Allen Harbor, a small job in Bass River, any of those, like we want to be like a quick to shore one so we can work on it, and you know, it's just an easier one.
Plus, you want to lay a bunch of pipe out.
It's one that we can play and fluctuate with it, see what it's actually doing for performance. We want to kind of stretch the line of the pipe to see how much it actually pumps, like that kind of things. But this weather is really kind of crippling us as far as doing a productive test.
Right. Do you have any other thing that you want to ask on this?
The dredge.
Right. The only thing that I'm looking for.
We're going to take delivery.
The 15th. I think they're going to hit their deadline on the 15th, but I'm not taking it.
We're not going to accept it until we run it through its make sure it works properly.
So they do that, or we do that?
It's a combination. I think they'll have a couple of representatives.
But formal delivery isn't made until after it's been run through all of its tests.
Basically, all I'm looking for, I'm not going to put this to a vote, but basically what I'm looking for today is consensus. I was going to say the board, but Mary Pat's not here, so basically from you, that I can continue acting as chair, working not only with Steve, Jack, but also county council, because, you know, we do want to make sure that we are meeting, and everyone's meeting their obligations under the contract. So
yeah.
I get a nod with you on that, right? That's all I need.
Got it.
Okay. Great. Nothing else to update on that, pretty much.
Besides, you know, the guys are trying to do what they can.
Yep.
And
you call me daily on it, so thank you.
Yep.
2 weeks.
Appointments. If you don't mind, we're running kind of late. Can I put off this appointments to the county commissioner until Chairman Flynn returns again?
Can we put it on for next week? Just as.
We're going to put it on every week. Hopefully, she'll be here. Though.
Okay.
She actually asked Jack to make sure that she wanted to have, I guess she had some questions and some inputs on our draft that you and I put together.
That's fine.
New business, I do not have any new business. That brings us down to the 9, which is the commissioner's actions. The first one is the timesheet. There's two of them here. I'll be looking for someone to move to approve the timesheet of Jack Units, county administrator for the period of December 10th, 2017. Through December 23rd, 2017, as presented.
So moved.
And I'll second it. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That brings us to the second time sheet. I'd be looking for someone to move to approve the time sheet of Jack Unis, County Commissioner, for the period of December 24th, 2017 through January 6th, 2018, as presented.
County Administrator.
County, what did I say?
Commissioner.
Sorry, County Administrator.
So, yes. So moved.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The next one is an authorization of an amendment to an agreement. I'd be looking for someone to move to authorize the extension of an amendment to an agreement with the United States National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute, WUI. WUI?
HUI.
HUI. For a grant to the Cape Cod Cooperative Extension in support of the HUI Seed Grant Program, awarding supplemental funding in the amount of $30,000 and extending the period of performance through August 31st, 2018, as presented.
So moved.
And I'll second it, and we've already had staff kind of bring us up on this earlier. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I'm looking for someone for authorization of renewal contract crack sealing. I'm looking for someone to move the authorization, the renewal of a contract with Crack Sealing, Inc. and Seal Coating, Inc. for crack fillings in the towns within Boswell County for the period of April 1st, 2018 through March 31st, 2019, as presented.
So moved.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Another contract renewal. I'm looking for someone to move to authorize the renewal of a contract with R.J. Gabriel Construction Company and Leo, I killed this one last year, Vinette Company, Inc., to provide drainage items to towns within Boswell County for the period of April 1st, 2018 through March 31st, 2019, as presented.
So moved.
I'll second it. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Authorization of another renewal of a contract. I'm looking for someone to move the authorization of the renewal of a contract with Aggregate Industries, Cape Cod Aggregate Corp., Lawrence Lynch Corp., P.A. Landers, Inc., and Robert Childs, Inc., to provide roadway materials to towns within Boswell County for a period of April 1st, 2018 through March 31st, 2019, as presented.
So moved.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Another renewal of a contract. I'm looking for someone to move their authorization of the renewal of a contract with Bartlett Consolidated LLC, Highway Safety Systems, Inc., Lawrence Lynch Corporation, and Markings, Inc., for miscellaneous public works in the towns within Boswell County for a period of April 1st, 2018 through March 31st, 2019, as presented.
So moved.
It's been moved out, seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Another extension of a discharge of mortgage. I'm looking for someone to move the authorization and execution of a discharge of a mortgage by Keith Robert Hendershot to Boswell County, acting by and through the Cape Cod Commission, dated November 29th, 2011, as presented.
So moved.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Commissioners' reports. I think I covered everything in basically my discussions with the Paul thing and the dredge thing update. So I think I'm all set right now. Do you have anything?
So, we're 30 days away or so with anything else going on with the commission anyway at this point, because he's here for another month, right?
He's here for another month. I do think you're going to see probably a recommendation coming forth from the Cape Cod Commission Board, whether they decide to do any action on this Thursday or not. They are meeting Thursday before the Cape Cod Commission meeting. I imagine that's to
probably an executive session, probably.
No, it's not an executive session. No, executive committee. I said executive
session. But they won't be going into executive session?
No.
Okay.
Jack, you have anything for us?
I think you guys covered a lot of ground today.
Yeah.
I'll withdraw.
Okay. Steve, do you have anything you want us to update on for anything?
Just to make you guys aware, and I think Jack was going to do it too, it was just the MAC was activated last week, and they did a great job. Phil Bird,
yeah,
and
Sean O'Brien. Yeah, that's why the health department wasn't here.
Yeah, no, they did a fantastic job.
He's still trying to catch up and sleep, Sean.
Yeah, so they did a fantastic job with the storm. Once again, we didn't have any real problems here at all, but throughout the Cape, there was a lot of issues, and they deployed, you know, everything that we could to help them out. So they did a great job, so they should be commended for that.
Yeah.
Other than that, that was it.
All right.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, working with the delegation, the town of Provincetown, on emergency declaration.
Yeah, do they need anything from us as far as
flooding?
Sean has put together a package. He's getting all the input from the DPW guys across the Cape on the damages that was done. And it was really areas like Chatham. Brewster had some, Bonsable had a little, Sandwich had a lot, and Provincetown was crushed. So he'll be assembling that data for MEMA.
Are they going to need anything from us as officially from the board as far as asking Keating to file that this be a...
That's a good point.
Not a national
declaration.
Declaration of
emergency.
Emergency, whatever it is.
The first step was for their board on Monday night to declare the state of emergency, which I think they did.
Which
board? Selectmen?
Board of Selectmen.
Okay, yeah, they have to do it.
That goes up to MEMA. And then they take it from there. And that's where Sean is putting together the documents to support MEMA.
Do you know, Jack, other towns have also taken the action? I know Chatham had a lot of...
I haven't heard from other towns on that yet. I know Chatham was looking for a pump on Saturday, and Steve and I were trying to help Sean locate a pump, but that's all I heard from Chatham. And their problems were more private than public, so it might change things a little. I don't know.
Well, private people can also file for a designation of a
FEMA thing,
a national emergency or whatever it is, too. Yeah. So people should know that.
Well, Provincetown obviously is going to include all the businesses on Commercial Street that have a couple feet of water in their basement right now that's frozen.
Okay.
So.
All right.
Thank you.
Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All those in favor?
Thank you.